I don't lose. Everybody give me a. Actually, no, I got your initiative right here. Tiva, you are up first. I do need a initiative from you. Joe, what's your character's name again?
My dice. Kothis, Kothis the Devout.
There we go, Kothis. For some reason, I have the worst name in your name. Kothis. All right, give me a 1d6 roll plus your dex mod, and we'll fit you into the initiative.
I got a six.
So you're gonna be right after Tiva. And Zan. Let's see. The, and I don't know exactly. I think we ended it at the end of our round, but I'm gonna say we did anyway. So with that case, Tiva, you are on the ground unconscious at the moment. So we won't worry about you. Kothis, during this time as the others are getting their asses kicked, apparently you've been wandering about town. I had you basically just stay back for last session, kind of hanging out in town and seeing what you could do there, maybe helping out the people and stuff since everything was getting pretty rough there. But you would have seen the others headed to High Point along with Nash and John. So I'm going to assume they probably were just basically catching up to them and to see what's going on. So when you come into High Point, the front gates of this, it's sort of a, not really a castle, but it's sort of like a miniature guard keep that is built into the side of Yggdrasil, this massive tree. And you come past the front gates. From your time here in Crux, you know that these gates have never been opened. There's always a couple of guards there, and their gates are closed to the basic populace. But now the gates hang wide open. You can see the door to the keep as well, across the courtyard and into it. It leads up into a stairwell that heads up about 3 stories. You can see that that gate is opened as well. From where you're at, you can see what looks to be one of the guards laying on the ground at the base of the stairs, as well as Tiva laying on the ground. And you can see probably the hooves of Zahn. They are at least one move away from you at the moment, though. So you are up. What would you like to do? As far as what's going on, you can probably hear screaming and fighting going on, but you can't really see much more because they're up beyond your eye level. Oops, you're muted, Joe.
Oh, sorry about that. Er, that would help. Where am I and where's everyone else in relation? Like, am I just in the group? Are we?
Look, you would be in the courtyard outside, basically just trying to catch up to these guys. From what you can see across the courtyard of this keep, and the stairwell goes up into the keep itself, you can see Tiva and this guard both look dead. They're down on, excuse me, down on the ground, but
Then
you can't see all the way up.
I'm going to Tita.
Okay. That would be a move. You'd have to take like a double move, so you would reach her at the end of this round. But as you run towards him, you can see Tiva is definitely on the ground. She looks quite badly injured. There's a guard next to her too, whose head is head smashed in a bit. You can see Zahn halfway up the stairwell in between the two of these, but he has this really confused, crazed sort of look on his face. And you can hear the fighting up beyond that, up on the floor above you. You can't see into the room really. Seda would be right in the doorway, but you can definitely hear fighting going on. Zahn, you stand in the stairwell. All around you, you can see these beetles, these lovely beetles that you've come to love so much, just scrambling across the walls, down the stairs, across your skin, biting at you, stinging you. Tiva, or, well, actually, you don't see Tiva, you see two guards that lie on the ground in front of you, but you still have Seda and two guards behind you.
Two guards behind me. Okay.
One is engaged with Seda, and, well, the other one would be Nash and Jean, who's in the back of the room, but.
Okay, I'm dancing the barrier, smashing away the beetles while I'm doing that, like flailing around crazily with my shield and Ramhead Warhammer, and probably screaming a little girlishly. But I mean, things have to be done, so how much distance is between the one Seda is fighting and me?
You're halfway down the stairwell, which would be 20 feet.
Oh, that's enough for a charge, sir.
All right.
Yeah. So let's go ahead. Come on. That's a 16 on the die already?
That's perfect.
Oh, good. Okay. What's my charge? My charge is +1d8 plus strength. So 4. Well, could be worse. So could I totally run into him. The stairs are a little bit steep and break up my charge a little bit, so it's not as much impact as I was hoping for. But yeah. Oh, and EMS has to make a safe versus paralyze.
Would be knocked. Does not, so he is knocked down. So he's prone. Okay. Yes, these stairs don't cooperate too well with that skeletal leg of yours. Can't quite get the oomph behind this, but you will be able to slam into him as Seda's standing next to him and throw him across the ground. He'll slide a few feet on the ground, his sword that he has skittering away and clattering against the wall. This room that you're back up into, if you guys remember, there's a door in the far back where Nash and John is, with the stairway that leads up to the floor above you. There's also a store off, or a door off to your right.
It's a portcullis, right?
Yes, yes. Yep. And then same thing to your right in the side of this room. The room is, what is it, 20 foot by 40 foot, 40 foot long, 20 foot wide, but the door on the right-hand side as well with a pair of stairs leading back down somewhere, which you can't see either way from the vantage point you're at, where they go. And that would put Seda up. Seda, you have been passing most of your things, it looks like, so you aren't affected by any weird visions or anything at the moment. You are just basically beating the shit out of people. So yeah, you have a guard who just got slammed to the ground by Seda next to you. Now across the room is Nashinjan. You can see he's pulling back his crossbow bolt. Again, this time he has this black-looking arrow with a black head on it that he's notching into it. What do you do? I'm not sure if you're muted or... You're
totally muted.
Sorry about that. There you go. So, Nash and John, he is become an enemy, correct?
Mm-hmm. Assumably.
Seemed to be, okay. So, is he the closest of the current bad guys to me?
Unless you want to count the guy who's on the ground knocked out. Well, he's awake, but he's knocked under the ground by Zahn. He's next to you. But otherwise, Nash and John's the only other one up in here.
All right. So at this point, I would move to Nash and John then, since he's got an arrow. If Zahn's got him on the ground, he's probably about to get trampled to death or worse. So I'm going to move to Nash and John with my great axe and just try and. I don't know. Should I try to talk sense into him the easy way or the hard way?
Oh, remember, this is Seda we're talking about.
That's very true. Seda, who is now, greatly handicapped. So we're going to do this the real easy way. So she's going to go at him with the great axe and just try to... try to lay him down.
All right. So give me an attack roll. All
right. So Seda gets a +6 with that. So I actually rolled a 20.
Nice. Unfortunately, I need a second attack roll as well, though.
Okay. This one I got a 10. Do I still add my bonus?
Yep.
So it would be a 16 total.
Basically, just need both totals.
Okay. So 26 and 16.
All right, nice. Go ahead and do damage.
Okay. Great axe. That should be a D10. And this one, 7.
Okay. So you charge forward. You can see your axe just completely cleaves into the shoulder of this man who is notching his crossbow bolt. And he'll look up sort of this confused, almost... sorry sort of look on his face. Then you see his mouth widen, very, very wide, just keeps stretching across his face. And you can see the sides of his lips, the sides of his mouth start to split, and it's just this weird, demonic grin that crosses across his whole face. And then as you blink, in front of you is this woman. Looks like a guard. She's dressed in her guard regalia. You've completely cleaved in half. Beside you, Nashin John stands there. He just chuckles a little bit.
So I just cleaved a guard woman in half.
Yes, you did.
Sweet.
And let's see, the guard is going to basically just pick himself up with you, Zahn, and, well, he ain't going to get attacked because he's picking himself up. So, yeah, right beside you, though, you can see he was getting ready to load this crossbow bolt in Seda. Instead, he just grabs it and tries to plunge it into the back of your shoulder. And I'm going to assume a 19, 21 hits you. I need a save. I need a save versus poison.
What?
For me or for Zahn?
For Seda.
Oh, good.
See, I thought he was talking to me, and you're like, what the me? Who the hell is he attacking me? She just doesn't. She cares about me.
She cares.
Save versus poison?
Yes.
Thank God I'm a dwarf.
Yeah.
Yeah, I made it.
All right.
Number six.
You can feel this arrow bolt cleave right in between those creases on your armor, right down under your collarbone, and right in your whole arm seems to go numb a little bit and kind of hangs awkwardly for a second before your constitution kicks in. You're going to take 10 points of damage, though. And with that, you can see he draws this great sword from his sheath across to his back and sort of steps back a few, leveling it down in your direction, then combative sort of stance. And this, again, this huge, wide, demonic smile on his face. If you look at him, though, where you're at, Satan, Zahn, where you're from, too, since you can see him across the room, you can see part of his face is almost porcelain-like. It's almost like this porcelain mask is starting to form across his face.
Yeah,
this
you wide, look shit, exactly. Yeah.
This huge, wide grin starting to become the painting on the mask. And doo-doo-doo. Back up to Teeva, which we will hold on to you for just a moment. Since Kothis, you are right there with Teeva. What would you like to do?
I'm going to try to help Teeva. Teeva is down. Teeva needs Kothis's help.
He needs the fondongle.
Praise be the fondongle. Absolutely. So, my question to you is, where would I have been with my spells? What I had on my sheet for current was two first, one second, and no thirds left at the moment. But I don't know if I would rest in there or not.
Yes, you would have. They had a complete full rest, so you would be all back to full in between when this before and now. So, yes,
in
you would.
In that case, I'm going to... we want to cure some wounds, I'm guessing. Oh, well, I mean, first off, can I... She's down. Can I tell if she's down and out or down and dead or just down?
She is unconscious. She's not dead yet.
Okay, good. In that case, but the immediate threat to us, the only one next to her has his head caved in, right?
Correct, yep. The other one, the other thing else is going up in the room above you, which is 40 feet away from where you are.
Okay, well then let's cast a cure. Hang on. Where am I? I got my Lamentations book. It's missing. My PDF, sorry. There it is. No, I didn't have it. Where'd it go?
Let me see. I got Cure Light, I'm assuming is the one you're going to do. Yeah, you don't have right. Cure Wounds. Yeah, Cure Light, which is 1d6 hit points plus number of points equal to the caster of the level, or level of the caster.
Okay, so... 1d6 plus 5.
You can roll that for us, and she is down.
Well, all right. Then that would be a 4 plus a 5 for a 9.
9 points of health back there, Teeva.
Okay. That's down to 2.
And do you want to stay where you are, Kothis, or do you still can move if you want to?
I'm going to, now that I have gotten Teeva back a little bit from the... From the edge of oblivion, I'm going to move to between her and up the stairs. Not necessarily going all the way up the stairs, but I'm intervening between her and anything that might come down.
Gotcha. All right, Teeva. In that case, since you did not die, I still need that 1d20 roll to see what kind of horrible thing you might have happened to you.
Y'all hear her good, by the way? I'm sorry, what?
God. 1d
Can y'all hear her okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I got a 4.
4.
Don't lose any intelligence because one of us is enough.
Or limbs.
Limbs are okay. I can be your hands.
All right. Well, nothing's going to happen just yet. So you'll have to sit and wait to see.
Oh, no.
So in that case, Teva. Oh,
really?
I'm just going to have you and Kothos basically split since you sort of came up after him. So you are now up then, Teva. As you wake up, you can see Kothos casting the spell over, and then he moves up halfway up the stairwell that you're at. All around you, though, again, is just this water pouring down the stairwell. It feels like you're floating on top of the water. You can cough a little bit, and it just blood that kind of spurts forth from your mouth. This thick, foamy stuff on the top of the water. But yeah, you're not sure where the water is coming from, but it's just pouring down the stairwell from above.
Okay, so I'm at the bottom of the stairwell now?
Yep, it's probably going to be maybe like up to your shoulders right now.
Okay, oh boy. Well, I'm going to start trying to swim up and see if I can get over. So I see Kothos, though, correct?
You do, yes.
Okay. Well, she's going to look at him and say, thank you so much. I feel so much, well, I feel somewhat better.
Don't thank me. Thank the Fandango.
Well, thank you, Fandango. And she holds her hands up.
That's better.
And then she splashes back down. And so she, you know, she back up again. So, but do we see Zan and...
From where you're at, no, because you're at the base of the stairwell, well, part of the way up now. It would be basically a move action for you to get all the way up to the top, but that'll be your turn. You can still hear the fighting going on, though.
Okay, but if you're going to look at Kovitz, we need to get up there and help them. So she's going to make her way up there, up the stairs. Try to, anyway, with water coming down.
Yeah, right. Give me a saver's paralyzation.
Oh, God. Okay, let's see. So I need to get above? Or
yes,
below? It's above. Okay. Yep. Sometimes a little confusing. It's like, I don't know if it's below or above.
Some are above and some, yeah.
Yeah. I got a 5. I lost.
Right. Take a few steps, and you can see the water just is filling up faster than what you're moving. If you look back, Kothos, you don't see this water that she seems to be in, but you can see Teva like basically trying to swim up the stairwell and sort of falling back down and scrambling. With that, you will start to slip a little bit, Teva, and you can feel yourself fall beneath this water, and everything is black around you. It feels like hands or tendrils or something sort of grasping at some of your clothing, your ankle. You can feel one rub across the side of your face as something's trying to get a hold of you and pull you down into this water. Zan, you are up. This guard has picked himself back up in front of you, but you were before him, so.
Turn my butt to him and kick Deluxe.
All right.
I rolled a 1.
So you do not kick him after all.
So I slip.
Face first. Yeah, he'll sidestep out of the way of this really quick, and that actually... Oh, nope. Seda, you would be up then. You can see Zan back behind you, fighting with this guy, trying to kick him as he's quickly dodging out of the way as he brings his sword around to engage Zan. She looks like he had... he looks like he has a handle for the moment, though. Instead, you have this woman who you've just completely cleaved in half in front of you. You can see both halves sort of slide apart and just hit the ground in this sickening slump sound. And Nashin Jean, who's right beside you with his sword drawn.
So after having gotten stabbed in the back and seeing what's going on, she doesn't understand, obviously, for obvious reasons. She knows she got stabbed in the back. She doesn't understand what just happened with the woman, but now she's a little freak. So she basically just turns at Nashin Jean and she just screams, "Don't do that!" And then she swings and tries to hit him with her axe.
Go for it.
Well, with my bonus, I got a 12.
I need a second attack as well. With your bonus.
With my bonus, I got a 15 that time.
All right. Again, you swipe your thing. It looks like it smashes into his arm. He takes a few steps back, and but it's a strange feeling when you hit him. It doesn't feel like you're striking his armor. It just feels like this, almost like you struck flesh. And again, this quick blink of your eyes, and you see another younger guard, maybe 18 or 19 at best, probably a young rookie recruit, just tore apart in front of you, your axe still dripping with his blood as he hits the ground. His Nashinjans is about 10 feet away from you at the moment. More of his face is covered by this portion. You can see his hands are starting to turn into this smoky, black, wispy type stuff. Nashinjan is up. So he actually, Nashinjan's going to run forward in that case towards you, Seda. I rolled a 1 and a 2, so he does not do absolutely anything to you. You can feel his blade as it swipes across the side of your face and grazes across your chest, but doesn't get through your armor. Over on your side, Zahn, this guy with the sword, 14, does 16 hit you?
16. Ranged, yeah, it does.
5 points of damage then as you turn your ass towards him to try and kick him. He just buries his blade into your back of your flanks.
Shit.
Opens up a bit of a wound and steps back a few feet out of your step. And you can see, looks over his shoulder at Nashinjan almost like he's wondering, if he should continue doing this, or he doesn't look like he's very comfortable in the situation, or he's a little confused or something. That'll be the end of the round. Kothus, you can see behind you Tiva. She looks like she's trying to swim in the middle of the air. She's standing on the steps, but just like swimming in place. And, looks like she's gasping for air. Behind her coming up the stairs, you can see a man, this noble-like gowns. He has a flower lapel on his chest. You recognize him as Veritas Mav, the town noble here. And he has his sword drawn, and he just starts running towards Tiva. You are up, Kothus. What do you do?
Well, I'm going to stop going up the stairs, and I'm going to turn around and say, "Excuse me," and hold up my left hand and say, "Can I help you, brother?"
You can see he looks like he's running right towards Tiva, but he'll look up this little bit of a panicked look on his face and says, "The whole town is under attack. We need to figure what's going on. Just get upstairs and help your friends. I'll handle Tiva." He'll run over. It looks like he's going to grab a hold of her, or he's trying to help her.
Okay, in that case, I'm going to say, raise B, and turn around and go back up the stairs.
Wait. Who's grabbing me?
Veritas Mav. But you do not see him, so don't worry.
I don't see him?
You do not. But you feel tentacles and weird hands trying to grab a hold of you.
Yeah, you see a merman or something.
In that case, because you'll run up the stairs. Behind it does look like Veritas is trying to help her. It looks like he sets the sword to the side. He's trying to, lift her out of whatever she's in or something, or trying to, wake her up from the vision she's having. Upstairs, you'll come face-to-face with Zahn, who is facing the wrong direction to be fighting this guy that he is fighting. This huge gash across the flanks of him, and behind him, the guard. Across the room, 40 feet away on the far side of the room, Seda and Nashinjan stand there. Nashinjan seems to be surrounded by 6 other guards. All of them look paralyzed, as if they can't move or something.
Well, So after what actions do I have left after my
whatever you want to, just can't move. But I mean, you're right there face to face with Zahn and this other guy, but
other guy
has a spell or attack or whatever.
Okay, in that case, and it's obvious that Zahn is, even though facing the wrong direction, has been engaged in combat.
Yes, with this other, right. Yep.
When that
the other guy looks like he's sort of confused or doesn't really want to be here, but he's doing his job, basically.
Oh, okay. In that case, I'm going to take out the trusty righteous cudgel of the Fandangle. Sassafras staff, that's all it is. And try to whack him on the noggin. So let's see here. That's rare for that. I missed. I rolled a 1 and I got a -1 because of my strength. So I got a 0.
So sort of just swoops past him. imagine Zahn sort of as he flails about, his kind of ass checked you across part of the room, so your trusty Fandango goes swinging crazy. Zahn, you are up. From where you're at, you can actually see down the stairwell as well, and you can see Veridus is trying to help Tiva, who seems to be caught in some sort of vision or something, but he is showing up as well.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that right now, but there are more urgent targets. So I look behind me. Is the guy still there?
There's a giant beetle there.
Oh, hell! Oh!
Just crawling with more beetles. It's like a beetle with beetle fleas just crawling all over this thing.
Oh, another kick.
Keep it together, brother goat.
I didn't hear that. I pretend I didn't hear that. 7 plus 7 is 14. 14?
Yes.
Oh, thank God. Okay. Let's say... What's my kick? Oh, 2d6. Okay. 6, 7.
Nice.
Poof!
You can hear the cracking of the carapace on this thing, and sickening clump sound as it takes a few steps back and bumps into the table behind it. You'll see him give a quick kick to this kid. Kothus is on, nails him in the gut, and he falls back a few. In front of you, Zahn, you look down the stairwell. You can see Veridus is grabbing a hold of Tiva and seems to be trying to help her for a moment. But you see something else, too. You see this... It looks like a shadow sort of opposed itself onto the wall. You don't see what's casting the shadow. And there doesn't seem to be anything there that's casting the shadow. But it looks like this just huge ogre-like form. It's there and then it's gone. You're not sure what you saw, really.
Oh,
Seda.
Another beetle.
You are up. In front of you is Nash and John. Again, like just a few feet within melee range. Most of his body has started to transform into this wispy, smoky-like apparition with this porcelain mask. He does have his greatsword with him. Still a little bit of a humanoid shape left.
I think that given that every time she tries to hit him, it turns into somebody good. What she's going to do is after missing and after he missed her, I think she's just going to just take, you know, she's got her axe in her hand. She's just going to leap and just try to grab him and possibly try and rip that mask off of his face.
All right.
Basically just going to try and, she knows that she's stronger than the average bear.
Do an opposed strength check then. So 1d20 plus your strength mod versus this right. Isn't very good. So
d20 plus my strength mod.
Yeah.
All right. All right, so that's a 14 plus the 2 is 16.
All right. So, yeah, you can come through. You can sort of grab, your hands go through this wispiness a little bit, but there still seems to be something tangible or something flesh-like still there for the moment as you wrap your arms around it. And you can hear him grunt as you drag him down to the ground. You have him in a grapple, so next turn you can try to rip the mask off or do whatever it is you want to do. He'll get one chance to basically try to escape, but say that he can't attack. Well, actually, it would be his turn, so he can't try to escape. And give me another strength roll. Odds are you're going to get. I got a 9.
For me?
Yep.
I got 11 plus 2.
Cool. So yeah, you're able to hold him as he struggles back. He can pin his arm down a little bit, so this great sword isn't within your range. So for wrestling, yeah, on your next turn, you can basically attack him and do damage or try to rip the mask off or whatever it is you want to do since he failed his escape check. And yeah, this other guy is just going to rush forward. You can see these beetle pinchers, these spiky-like legs coming at you, Zahn, from behind. Another 2 points of damage as you can feel these pinchers just sink in around your abdomen, sort of crushing a little bit. A couple of ribs will snap. And give me a save versus poison, please.
Oh. 13. Yeah, I made it.
All right. Cool. Yeah, you can see this thick, black, greenish sort of mucus just dripping from this thing's pinchers, these mandibles that come around you. And you can feel it enter your system, holding it back for the time being, but he has a hold of you. Unless you want to escape as your action, he's going to deal auto damage while he has a hold of you. And to do that, at the end of the round, Kothis, you are up. You can see this man who has been attacking Zahn has a dagger in his hand, and he's basically leapt upon her and is just stabbing the hell out of her. Him, sorry.
Yeah.
I can help you, brother. Go. Okay, so let me see. So Zahn is effectively grappled.
Yes.
At the moment. And damaged.
Yes.
Okay, let me see.
And then across the way you can see Seda has Nash and John, who looks perfectly normal to you. It just looks like himself onto the ground and is like clawing at his face and stuff.
Okay, well he's you know, you do you, nobleman. I gotta help out. I mean, because let's face it, you know, a buck of gel would be a heck of a convert for the Fondongle. So I'm staying here. I'm thinking of the numbers. So, but. Okay. Kothis is not a strong person, so I don't know if he could actually freeze on, but he can cure light wounds. So that's what I'm going to do first.
I'm not too damaged, though. I still have 18 of 34 hit points. So he still looks... I mean, he's injured, but he doesn't look like...
So what you're saying is if you were a full loaf of bread healthy normally, you're down there's to about half a loaf of bread.
Exactly. Okay. All right.
So in this case, because, you know, a brother of the cloth is all about bread and feeding people. So that's his. In that case, it's time did he lose the righteous cudgel? Did you say the righteous cudgel went flying because of his
yes
terrible fail? Well, then he's going to collect the righteous cudgel of the Fondongle first off. I don't know how far it went, but I'm going to go get it.
All right. Across the room. So, like, basically your move action, you could still cast a spell or something if you want.
Okay, in that case, let me check that real quick. Sorry. I'm still not familiar with all of the Lamentation spells. So I want to cast... Here we go. There we are. Let's cast a... Oh, wait a minute. Can I cast a spell by touch on Zahn from where I am or not?
That'd be fine. Okay.
In that case, we're going to cast Heroism.
Oh, right. Heck yeah.
Now we're talking.
I think I need the...
So... Do you want to roll for that, Morgan, or should I?
Let's see if there's 1d4 levels worth of hit points and saving throws. So, you can go ahead and roll.
Okay. In that case, fingers crossed. Oh, three, yes!
So basically, you just give yourself 3 levels on. So 3, whatever your hit points would be for that. And then you're going to have your saving throws are all going to be as if they were 3 levels higher than whatever you currently are.
Yeah. And my attack as well?
That's great. If you're a fighter, attack bonus
as well. Yeah.
Don't stop this thing!
For
the greater glory of the Fondom.
And then this lasts for 5 rounds.
Awesome.
Yeah. Sweet. Kiva, you can feel these hands grabbing a hold of you. They're kind of slimy, wet, and it seems like they're trying to pull you down into this water. If you look up, you can see it's just getting deeper and deeper as you try to swim up and splash out, but you can't seem to find the top of this water. Give me a saver's... I'm going to say poison in this case.
I got a 1.
You take this gasp on, you know, out of fear of panic, whatever, and you can just feel all of this water enter your lungs as you start to coughing and start to spasm. Ouch. It's not permanent, but take -6 constitution for the moment.
-6 constitution?
Yep. From start to drown. If that temporary constitution damage reaches 0, though, you're dead.
Okay.
And what do you do as you're panicking in this water? You can't find the top. You can feel hands grabbing a hold of you, as if they're, seems to you like they're trying to hold you or pull you down, but.
Okay, so you said that there's hands that are grabbing me.
Yep.
But it feels like they're trying to pull me down.
Yes.
Okay, well, at this point, she's given up. She's going to just let the hands pull her down. Because she's tired, she's injured. It just seems like everything that she's doing is just nothing is helping. So she's just given up on everything. So she's going to let the hands pull her down.
All right.
Well, that's kind of dark and sad.
Jeez. You'll feel yourself falling deeper into this water. All around you just goes silent, goes dark. You can see this sort of wispy, black-like figure in the distance between the currents of the water around you. Again, you definitely feel something grabs a hold of your arm and your leg, maybe part of the back of your arm or something, and it's just dragging you back. And then, Tiva Zahn, you are up. Down the hallway, it looks like Veritas is just basically dragging Tiva up the stairs as she's just goes completely limp in his arms. Behind you, this bug has wrapped its mandibles around. You can feel it sinking into your flesh on either side, ribs snapping. And Kothis has seemed to have touched you with his fandango, no pun intended, as you feel very heroic now.
Yeah, I give it a very good kick to get out of his grip. So basically getting out of the grapple.
All right.
Yeah, that's a 17 on the die already. I guess that's...
Yeah, I only had a 7.
Yeah.
So yeah, you still have an action then if you want to do something. As you kind of heave this massive beetle-like bug off you, it falls back a few steps. If you turn or, you know, look over, you can see Seda has Nash and John on the ground and is like clawing at his face.
Yeah, So I push him back with my butt and then give it a good kick.
Right. Go for it.
12 on the die plus 10. 22, sir.
It's a hit.
7 damage.
That's enough to take him out. Oh, you can hear this crunch as you just smack into him. If you turn, you'll see this guard who has been fighting. It's no longer a beetle. Just go flying across the room and smash into the wall and sort of slide down. Part of his head splits open when it cracks against the wall. Obviously, it looks like his chest is caved in from this. Turn around and look. Yeah, Veritas is going to be pulling Sativa up the stairwell. She looks sort of just hangs there limply in his arms. But he'll come up and he sets her down next to you, Kothis, and sort of nods for you to try and maybe do something. He doesn't have any abilities like you have. But he'll draw his sword and he just runs past you, Zahn, over toward Seda and Nash and Jan are. And Seda, you are up. You'll see Veritas Mav enter this up from the stairwell with Tiva, set her down, and then run towards you with his weapon drawn. He would have brought Tiva up completely limp and looks like she's dead.
Nash and John did?
You have Nash and John on the ground. This would be Veritas Mav, the noble guy.
Well, she's still going to try and rip the mask off. Because if Tiva is dead, then she doesn't want to let him up again. So she wants to try and rip the mask away in the hopes that that's going to kill him.
Go for it. Give me a... How about a dexterity? As you try to get a hold of this. So yeah, give me a dexterity plus 20 plus your dex mod.
I rolled a 19 on the die.
Oh, then you got it.
Yeah. I don't have a mod.
So you dig your hands underneath this porcelain mask and start to pull on it free. If you look over across the way, Zahn and Kothus, you'll see Seda just dig her eyes into dig her fingers into Nashin Jean's eyes. And it looks like she's just trying to literally rip his face off. And he just begins screaming, this blood pouring down the side of his face. From where you're at, Seda, it looks like you grab underneath this thing and just completely rip this porcelain mask off of it. Underneath is just the skin and bones left of a skull of this man's face, and you can hear him screaming. And then everything around all of you seems to blink a little bit. You don't feel yourself in water anymore, Tiva. You just see yourself staring up at Kothus. There's no more beetles that seem to be bothering you, Zahn. This young kid instead, this dead guard that you crushed. Across the way, Nashin Jean is just going to have his face just completely tore apart by you, Seda.
Oh.
He is no longer looks like this porcelain masked thing or a smoky visage or whatever. He looks like a normal man who's just completely ripped the face off of. Veritas will stop where he's at and sort of look around at all the chaos. What do you guys do?
I dust myself off.
Tiva's gonna raise up and just cough. Just, I thought I was gone.
Seda would, of course, immediately jump up and run over to Tiva.
And then Tiva gets smothered.
are you carrying the guy's face?
Oh, God.
Or drop his face
before? So I'm assuming I would just rip the mask away and throw it off to the side.
I'm just curious because, you know, I'm looking for any embellishment that I can in that. This already
you're gonna wear the dude's face?
I'm not sure. I'm hoping he's talking about the porcelain mask.
I hope so too.
I'm sure that's probably on the floor.
There is no mask or anything anymore. It's just parts and pieces of Nash and John's face.
Ferret, it's just this so there Both were around. There were more of one of each, and
Hold up his hands. He's like, I know.
Oh, thank the gods.
He said, I was down on the streets, and you told me when that man, he was a doppelganger of sorts, or it wasn't him, and you know, I must admit I was a bit confused, of course. But no, he says, it seems to be a thing happening here. There's something, these things, he says, I don't know how to describe them. They're like ghosts with masks, and people have been saying that they saw them, and I saw one myself. They tried to attack me, but I was able to escape. I came here as soon as I could. I was hoping that perhaps Nashin Jean would help us, but, well, I don't think that's the case, as he looks down at his constable's torn-apart face. Says, what happened here?
Well, we were we had an appointment here, right? So we went up here after we saw a guard being doubled and one of those guards lying dead on the marketplace, and we thought we should come here, and that was apparently a very bad decision because we saw doubles here too, and we were attacked, and let me say it was a mess.
Step over to where Nash and John is. He sits down, you know, sort of leans down above this guy and looks at him. It looks like it really was him or something, but he says, I do not know. He says, I'm going to have to look into this matter. Something here, something's controlling these people or taking their places. This seems to be Nashin. It's not like the others, but just shakes his head. He's like, I will look into this. I'll have my people look into this. And he'll ruffle through Nash and John's pouch that he has, and he pulls out a square piece of white leather. And he'll sort of walk over and hands it, I guess, to you, Zan. He says, I spoke to Nashin before he was supposed to have this meeting with you. This here's the key. It says, upstairs, and he'll point over to where the porticlis is and up the stairwell. Says, there's a archway that leads into just a side room, but carry this with you. If you rub it along the walls, it'll open a portal back to Sigil. It's one way. Once you go back, you won't be able to come back through. He says, but this is what you wanted, and well, we have rooted out a bit of evil here in town, and to be honest, I don't know what to do from here, but that doesn't involve the lot of you. I can't thank you enough as it is, between helping the guild crafters and the fires and Ratatosk and this, and he says, you've done more than I can pay you for.
Are you sure? We can't leave you with this mess, can we? I look totally ashamed.
He says, what you do is, you know, up to you, my friends. He says, but I can't hold you to any words. You've done more than what I've even asked anyway. He says, it's not my place to demand more. If you wish to go home, then we will have this under control. I have plenty of men, and I can hire more if need be.
Well, I don't think that everything will be under control, to be honest, because of what we told you. But we have to go home, at least to find out more, you know.
Says, yes, there seems to be much more to this happening that's going on. Maybe the tree is dying. He says, I think we'll be okay. This seems to be the root of the problem. And he sort of looks over and Nash and John on the ground and seems to be taken care of, I hope.
He says, I hope so too. We'll be back. I promise. Not immediately, but we will.
If I'm ever in Sigil, I will have to take a tour then, eh?
Oh, absolutely. He smiles mildly.
He says, but yes, if you find anything, I'd be interested in knowing. It seems that whatever is happening here is with this tree and with the gods and with everything else, perhaps we're in the center of it somehow. I have my connections, contacts. I will see what I can learn. If I can find anything, I'll let you know. I'll let you know.
I hold out my hand and try to shake his, and I say, Blood, it was good meeting you.
And you too, Zan. I must say I was a little scrupulous of you all to begin with, but you're good folk, you're good folk. And I wish you the best. Say that, Tiva. I wish you get home. Enjoy your wine and your ale and your dwarven halfling things. Well, I guess Fandango bless you, Kothis.
And that Fandango shall bless you too. Totally oblivious to any sort of, sarcasm or cynicism on the part.
And he'll hand that piece of leather over to you, Zan, and sort of step back. He'll lift the lever on the wall that Nash and Jean dropped to lift that portcullis back up, and motions for upstairs. He's like, again, I thank you more than words can say. I'll be in touch. And good luck. And he'll just stand, waiting for you to make your choice.
I nod and I look at the others. Well then, let's go.
Sado will ask, are we going home?
Well, for now, it's my home. But it can be your home, too, for the moment.
She gets a frustrated look on her face and then just kind of looks at Tiva for for guidance on where to go.
Tiva just looks at Sado and just smiles briefly and says, let's play a band. And she gets up and she kind of dusts herself off and says, I just need some rest. I know whatever is plaguing this world is not going to stop with this town. While I would rather go home, I have a very bad feeling that this evil that is here is eventually going to make it to our home as well. And we have to do everything we can to stop it. So she gets up and she looks at Zan and just kind of gets this look on her face like, can I ride on your back?
Oh man, that big barrier just rolls his eyes and turns his butt to you. Do it.
So she climbs up on Zan and just kind of holds her head on, or she puts her head on Zan's back and just tries to snooze a little bit.
And I walk up the stairs. When I see the portcullis, I rub the piece of leather against the wall, and I wait for the portal to open.
Yeah, you can see it's kind of like almost chalky or like soap or something. It sort of disintegrates as you rub this leather across the wall, and this almost looks like just a black void of darkness fills up the small little archway. Kothis, what do you do?
Well, he watches as this wall seemingly dissolves into this dark opening, and has this internal dialogue and decides that it's not evil. And the Fandangle says it's okay. So then out loud he says, wherever I may roam, there's going to be home. I'm going with you guys. There wasn't any doubt he was going to anyway, but he's made this decision. There you go.
Beautiful. Does everybody step through?
Yes.
Yep.
So as you step through, Zan, this darkness seems to wrap around you, comforts you, almost like a blanket, you know, like when you were a child and you hid under the blankets from those scary stories your father used to tell. Your father, you remember him, right? Killed in the alleyway, his tail taken for prize money. As you step out of this darkness and once more into the light, you find yourself in your bedroom, Zan, that of your home. You're across the way. You can see your desk with the notes of, you know, your recent tours around town, the calendar, picture of your father sitting to the side, still a pouch of money you got your last tip from, you know, helping out the people and giving them a tour sigil. Behind you, Tiva, Seda, still on your back, and the follower of the Fandangle stepping through into this room as well. As you were all back home, you can look outside the window of this room, Zan. You can see the normal busy streets of Sigil. You can hear the creaking of the NNFFW sign outside your door that used to sort of almost rock you to sleep. Again, it just seems to lazily creak in the wind.
I didn't know there was a portal to my house, but welcome. I guess, I look around totally confused.
And with that, we will hop over to Dan in just a second. So all of you, we'll have Tiva, give me a 2d6 roll.
Oh, gosh.
2d6.
I got... seven total.
All right. Seven plus three, 10. So basically, I'll let you guys all ponder on yourselves for a moment. You're going to have a 10-month window. So think about what you've done during these 10 months here in Sigil. Maybe went back to work, or maybe you've tried to make home or anything you guys want, because I'll hop back over to you and I'll let you guys fill in the details of what you've been doing for the past 10 months.
Mm-hmm.
And are you back with us, Dan? Cool.
Yep.
All right. So we'll swing over to you. Why don't you give me a description and quick rundown of your character, Shai Saul?
Yeah. Shai Saul Adloon is a Githzeri mage, originally from Limbo. And he's noticed a change in the balance of Limbo where basically the forces of chaos are growing stronger and the powers of the like the leaders who like bring order to chaos is waning. So he's out trying to figure out what's going on, what's upsetting the balance.
Nice. So there's these people. Generally, they hold dominion over all the different factions of the world, and they're called Factals. Factal Daloth is one for the Githzerai, who is a leader of what's called the Fraternity of Order. They're basically very inquisitive people. They base all of their choices and their decisions on facts. So they tend to be ridiculed a bit or not really made fun of, but people think that they act too slow often, as they take sometimes months or years to finally come upon a choice to make it. In their defense, they wish to, you know, make the right choice and consider all angles of an argument and what have you. But the Githzerai are a major part of this Fraternity of Order. And you'll get up one morning, you'll have a note, a small knock on your door, and one of the temple guards for here in Limbo will give you a message asking you to meet with the Factal Daloth. You know this Githzerai, older, quite a bit older, one of the older ones here in Limbo, down at the Fraternity Order Cathedral. He's a bit of a prick from what you've heard, but he's honest and he's sincere and he wishes, in truth, to create a world with law and with order. Not necessarily good, but where everything has its place. But he seems to have called upon you this morning.
All right.
So as you get there, you can pass through the great cathedrals of Limbo, or basically just these massive cathedrals formed out of the chaos. Inside, artwork and architecture is beyond none. You can see Factal Daloth sits at a desk as you enter his small study. He motions for you to sit down. This grizzled old Githzerai, he has that Fu Manchu sort of mustache that hangs way down his chest. And a bit of a frizzy hair, his mottled yellow skin is covered in age spots and small moles. Though he still looks like he's in pretty decent shape. You've heard that he's quite skilled in unarmed combat. Says, Shai Saul, I've heard you've been scouring about here. You feel it, I assume. You feel the chaos that seems to be seeping through these walls, through our skin. Can you feel it? It's not right. It's not right.
I can not only feel it, I can see it.
And what does it look like?
Parts of the cathedral, they're warping, falling off, dissipating.
He'll rummage around on his desk and he pulls out this piece of paper and sets it down. You can see this charcoal sketch of what looks to be a Borier, which is sort of a centaur, but a goat instead of a horse.
Mm.
A small halfling, a dwarf, and this other human man with a staff. One of our patrons, name is not important. He was in Sigil, the great city in the sky, the city of doors. And he came upon this group. He is dead now, lost, form. His deity is gone. You see, Shai, when a deity dies, so do their followers. The proxies are obliterated, consumed to nothingness. Their followers lost from favor. That is part of what's going on here, Shai. There's something out there, there's somebody, someone, something that is causing a disruptance with the gods. I've been told you've been looking into this lately, but he'll stand up and walks across the room and shuts the door. Says, I have a bit of work for you, if you so take it. Says, he'll slide this picture over to you, the sketch of these people. Says, one of our Gisterai, traveled with these folks, and he points at the barrier, and this one, a bit, well, let's just say he knows his way around the city of doors. But of interest is these other two, you see. He points at the halfling and the dwarf. All of this chaos that's seeping in, these gods that are dying, these proxies consumed, it all seemed to have started with them. I've heard that, from a contact, that they are called the Sisters too. Not by flesh, but by bond. So I think they know more than what they have let on. But, the dwarf is a stubborn one. I've sent a few people to talk to her, but she seems like she doesn't know much, or at least it's a good facade. I think she's quite crafty. And the halfling, she's just very charming, and we often get sidetracked on conversations. But they know more than what they let on. Even if they don't know themselves, perhaps they just need a bit of order, a bit of leadership in their life, a bit of guidance to find it, to seek within themselves. But there's one other thing, Shai. You see, and he points at the barrier. Long time ago, when the gods were in creation, it was tumultuous. Some were created, some rose to power, some died. It was like an age of creation. But during that time, the Gith, we've been around for a long, long time. We crafted a watch, simple golden stopwatch. And he actually reached into his pocket and hold up his that he has. But it doesn't tell time. No. It tells the count of the astra, you see. It resets every few centuries, but it keeps track of the gods who fall from grace, those that turn to stone in the astral, their bodies drifting endlessly. That Borier, he stole our watch from our compatriots.
And you want me to find it?
I do. These group here, they are in Sigil. We can get you there. It might take a bit of time to track them down. It's a great city. We need that watch, and we need to know what the Sisters too know.
This can be done. You've chosen wisely in sending me as an emissary.
No, and why is that?
I have the means to find an item like that in a place such as the City of Doors.
Just the
they are as easy to find as you say. Shouldn't take long.
Good. But in all things, are things considered, take your time, delve deep, truly try to figure out what these Sisters too know. And this other man, he points at the human with the staff. Kothis is his name. I don't know what he plays in all of this. In fact, I don't think he even knows what he plays, but he must be somehow in with this. Perhaps it's coincidence, but as you know, nothing is ever truly coincidence. It all is at least one pixel of the image.
Everything has its place.
So go ahead and rest for the day. Gather your things and come by this evening. We will get you to the City of Doors. We will have money. We have room. You should be perfectly fine. There's a great cathedral there, much like this one, though a little more stable nowadays. It too is called the Fraternity of Order. You will have free room and board there, so make yourself at home. The other gift, there's many, many others. Have you ever been to Sigils?
I have not. Well, it will be a brand new experience.
It's quite a sight. It's quite a sight. But yes, I have a bit of work to do. We will have you all set and on your way soon enough. You should make your goodbyes and gather your things. And that he'll walk across. He'll stop for a second too and then come back, pick up that picture that he had sketched out and hand that to you. Ruffles around in his desk and pulls up a small manila sort of envelope sealed with wax and hands that. He says, you keep this image of them so you can find them easily enough. But this, he hands you that manila envelope. He says, do not open this unless you feel the need. It must be a need, Shai Sal. Do you understand?
He like quickly hides a smirk. I will not open it. I am to hand this over to these. And he looks down at the picture.
He says, no, no, no. You can keep that envelope. But when there is a need to open it, when you feel driven, when you feel like you must open it, then is the time. It is yours to keep.
He'd nod.
Excellent. He'll walk across and open up the door leading back out to the cathedral. You can hear this rumbling that goes on, almost like this mini earthquake. And he'll take a breath, and he seems to stare at the ground for a second, almost just holding his breath, waiting for it to pass. Eventually, it takes a few moments, just this little minor earthquake that rolls through. A couple windows in the distance you can hear crack. A couple pebbles fall from the ceiling, bounce across these cobblestones. You know, we're ridiculed for taking time to do the tasks that need to be done. Sometimes I wonder if it's all right after all. But we will figure this out. We'll figure this out, yes. Good luck, Shai.
Good nod.
Do you do anything else before you head on out to Sigil?
No, I feel like he wouldn't have many friends. He would spend most of his time exploring Limbo. So he would just get on it, excited for a new experience since he's been stuck in the monastery. Yes.
So when you come back through at the allotted time, you'll see this Factal Deloth there, and he'll lead you over. All these times maybe you've been here, around here, you've seen this doorway off to the side. You've seen people open it, and inside is nothing more than a basic pantry. It holds some foodstuffs, odds and ends, jarred goods and such. But he'll stand there beside it, and as you come up, he'll hand you what looks to be just a simple brass key, completely plain, not much in design. It says, the City of Doors, it thrives off of portals. It says, every portal has a key. Every key is different. It's not like just this one. It says, in this case, it'll work, but some might be a feather from a raven. Another might be a piece of chalk. Some might be the body of a dead elf. You never know. And where these portals are, you know, motion towards this pantry door. there are always some sort of portal. It might be a sewer grate, a doorway, an archway, underneath a bridge, through a window, anything that a person could essentially pass through. And with a proper key and with a proper portal, you can go anywhere. Anywhere in the city of doors, anywhere in the planes of existence, anywhere in the prime worlds, absolutely anywhere. Says, we crafted this one a long time ago. We don't often visit Sigil anymore. They are a chaotic bunch, and the whole place is just a shithole. But it's fascinating nonetheless. You'll don't enjoy it too much. He'll motion. Whoever uses this portal has to use the key. Open up the door with the key, pass through, and you will find yourself in Sigil. Just be warned, it's busy there.
He just like looked down at the brass key and add it to his necklace, which has like random baubles and stuff that he's found. And when he says, don't have too much fun, he'd say, no promises, before he walks through the door.
Yeah, it looks like you're getting ready to just walk into this pantry, but you'll walk into it and you immediately walk out of a pantry in a different kitchen, and you can see ahead of you these two dwarves cooking over top of this griddle. Looks like they're frying up steaks or something. This huge pot of boiling potatoes. You glance behind you. It's just a pantry behind you of their kitchen. Looks to be in the middle of some sort of small tavern or something. You can hear people yelling and screaming out front, so conversations going and everything happening. If you glance over out the door that swings open, it looks to be just a complete tavern full of dwarves. 20, 30 dwarves that seem to be in a bit of a rumble, tough house, typical dwarven tavern.
Yeah, I imagine he's really tall. So he's like, stepping out from this cupboard, and the dwarves just like look up, and I guess they wouldn't be too surprised since there's so many portals. But he'd just be like, excuse me, and just walk straight out.
See the two dwarves turn, this confused sort of look on their face. One of them will run over, walk into the pantry, look around, walk back out as you make your way through. Nobody will stop you in the tavern or anything, but it definitely looks to be a typical dwarven ale house, quite rowdy. A couple of barroom fights going on here and there, and mugs of ale being spilled everywhere. When you step out this tavern into the street, Sigil looks like a donut, but you are on the inside of the donut. So when you look up above you, instead of sky, it's just more buildings and people walking on streets above you. So you get what I mean? I don't know how else to explain it. So then it goes like a complete circle around, so you can walk all the way around it in any sort of direction and end up back where you are. And you will see imps, beholders, mind flayers, orcs, goblins, pretty much every possible mix of races and creatures that you can, walking down the streets with vendor shops, buildings. It looks like one huge, massive marketplace. Off to the side, when you look down the street to the right, you can see this huge growing cathedral that matches much of what you've been used to yourself. And you can easily recognize that as a fraternity of the order. Glance over to your left, though. Look over there. You can see a clock tower. Stands maybe 150, 160 feet into the air. The very top of it, instead of having clock faces or the numbers go around the clock, this one actually goes to 13 hours. And currently, it looks like it says about 2:50-ish. You don't know if that's morning or afternoon, though, considering there's no sky or anything in here. It's just these little orbs of light that seem to be hanging about and giving off. It always looks like a daylight. What do you do?
Well, I suppose I start with the Fraternity of Order. And he'd head to the place that he was directed to first, and ask around for what kind of assistance they can provide somebody new to the city.
It seems the woman at the desk, she's also a Gith, has been expecting you. She gives you a small pamphlet, has a room, money. Go ahead and toss in, like, you know, say 100 silver to your sheet. Basically everything to get you through. They provide dinner and breakfast every day, and they expect you to basically carry your weight, at least in helping either prepping meals or cleaning or doing something to carry your weight here. Otherwise, you have free room and board for as long as needed. I will hop over to the others for a moment. Whoever, which one of you wants to start on what you've been doing for the past 10 months?
Maybe I should start because Tiva wanted to take part in my business, if I understood that correctly.
All right.
Yeah, and she had to step away for a moment for the take care of some business. So, yeah, you can probably just do for both.
But why don't you describe your character, too, for Dan? That way he can get caught up on who everybody is.
Yeah, so Zan is a male warrior. Male.
We tend to forget that.
Yeah. So a mixture of sheep and man. He's not really old. He's actually pretty young, maybe beginning of his 20s. And right now, he is securing a new sign of NNFFW above the barn, which basically was his father's business center of his touring guides. And in the last 10 months, he would have built up the business again. His dad died, sadly, or was murdered, to be exact. And after some time of drinking in the various taverns around, especially around the Great Bazaar, he realized that something had to happen, and probably the halfling and the dwarf couldn't really find their way around without him. So he finally had some sympathy and started backing off from the alcohol and started setting up the business again. And I hope a little bit successfully. Well, at least I would imagine he could afford a new sign. Because Buck of Gel, well, that's still, of course, a thing. But, I mean, Dad isn't here anymore, so it would be only Zan's NNFFW business. Yeah, and of course he can't do all that stuff alone, so he decided to get help. And who would be better for that task than Tiva? And he would probably have taken her on guides or on tours all the time until she was ready to do her own little tours, probably only around the Great Bazaar because everything else would be too much. Yeah.
All right. Give me a percentage roll. Mm-hmm.
Oh, 100?
Well, it looks like you've done really well with your business.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, everything seems to be going pretty damn well for you, Zan. You're able to get, you know, things moving along. People seem to be quite interested in your travels. Do you share a lot of your stories with them on your little travel that you had outside? Because, you know, everybody has the tours where they've been and what they've done.
Yeah, probably at first you would have told, like, the real shit. And everyone was like, yeah, sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah, all that drunk in the corner again and such. But of course, that maybe tickled the interest of some people. And after he stopped drinking, his stories became a little bit more realistic because he realized you can't tell people that gods are dying. That's not good for business. So, yeah, you probably learned to tell the right thing at the right moment.
In the beginning, a lot of people were definitely, I'm not going to say really put off, but definitely took notice of you. You seemed to have a little bit of a celebrity following over the first few months as your stories got embellished and maybe other people started spreading rumors. And I imagine, Shysel, that you would have quickly caught on to word in the streets of this Zan fellow running the NNFFW. I've been able to track him down without any problem at all. His halfling compatriot. And what about Seda? Have you been hanging out with them, or you've been doing some of your own things?
No. So to give Dan a little bit of backstory real quick before I explain. So Seda is a dwarf that came from the Prime Plane, and she started off, she was not the brightest, she wasn't the brightest torch in the hold by any means. So she had intelligence of like 7, but had a big heart, and she was best friends with the halfling. She had an intelligence of 7 because she tripped and fell and smacked her head as a child, and it kind of knocked her silly. And then while adventuring with this ragtag crew, she took a vicious blow from a creature that happened to hit her in the head, and unfortunately, that knocked her intelligence down even more, almost cutting it in half. So she's very special and requires lots of supervision at this point. So I'm running with an intelligence of about 4 right now. So that being said, Seda does have pretty decent wisdom and realizes that she's probably not the kind of person who should be interacting with customers. As a dwarf, the one skill that she did have that was, in addition to smashing things, was architecture. So what Seda's been doing is she's been spending time actually as a laborer, helping build whoever the guild is that builds things in Sigil. I'm assuming everything is gilded.
Yeah.
So she'll be helping them and acting as primarily as a laborer because she's very, very strong. And also trying her best to try and learn the style of buildings, how they build here, this, that, and the other, possibly even like adding some of the her dwarven some dwarven advice into ways to maybe do things a little better, stronger. So that's the trait of dwarven building. But yeah, pretty much she's been spending the last 10 months just going to work every day as a essentially become a construction worker.
Nice. Let me find it real quick. I can tell you what faction actually does a lot of that. Imagine you would probably be in contact with what's called the Free League, Seda. Or maybe they could see you doing the work and stuff. They tend to do a lot of the, both on the bureaucratic side and government sort of thingies they get into, but they also handle a lot of the construction and road and government jobs per se and stuff like that. They don't really follow in the same belief of this whole, all the different factions you've ran into here. Some believe in the gods doing certain things, some don't really care, and it seems everything seems to revolve around the gods, who you've noticed. But the Free League, they really don't give two craps about any of this stuff. They're happy to just live, do their jobs, and make a good living for themselves, basically. So over time, they probably would have not necessarily maybe indoctrined you or anything to the group, but they would be the most, in touch with what Seda's been doing and up to this point, probably as well to some degree Zahn and Teeva, but Zahn follows a different one for the most part, but still.
So you said that would be the Free League?
Yep, the Free League.
Okay.
They don't have any sort of official headquarters or factals or anybody in the lead. They basically just kind of hang out in the Great Bazaar and help whatever they can do to basic laborers.
All right.
And did you want to add anything to yours, Teeva, since you're back, to what Micah said?
Maybe just a little bit. Well, for one, I do have a question. So that roll that you had me do when I rolled the 2d6 and I got a 7, uh-huh. What was that for? You never did explain.
Oh, that is for how many months passed? It was 2d6 plus 3, so you got 10, 10 months passed.
All right.
And I got your death roll has not come up yet, so you actually still got that under.
Okay, so then that brings me to the other question. The other one where I rolled a 4, and you said we were going to hold on to that one. So what punishment am I going to get for that?
Oh, that was from last game, wasn't it? I don't think that just came up yet either.
Maybe you should just stop talking so much.
Nope, neither has been triggered yet.
Oh.
So no, here's still hanging on. They're kind of triggered by a particular action or something that you do, and neither one has occurred, so you think you're perfectly fine for the time being.
Okay.
So you're the bubbly halfling.
I imagine maybe at some point over the past 10 months that it could have, but then we would have to retcon it and wouldn't get to actually enjoy it as much, so.
Oh, yes, we would definitely want to be able to enjoy it.
Yeah, totally.
Okay. But yeah, so she's basically just been working with Zan, being Zan's little helper, so to speak. No, definitely pun intended, because, you know, she's tiny. But she's starting to come back to more of a normal life, and she's starting to get her bubbliness back that she used to have before all the chaos happened in the realm that they're in. So she's just been helping out Zan and also maybe doing some small little tours on her own. And so, but yeah, she's just been getting back up to the way she used to be.
Nice. And for Seda and Tiva, have either of you really looked into how to get back home, or is you just put that completely on the shelf for the time being? Or
Seda wants to get back home, but I don't think that Seda is going to be very good at trying to figure out how to get back home at this point.
Yeah.
I mean, she can barely read her own name at this point. So
Tiva has tried here and there, but she was just unsuccessful. So she just kind of put that in the back of her mind right now. And, you know, she just figures that she's helping out Zan. This is the life that she's going to pursue for the time being.
Gotcha. And Kothis, what have you been up to the past 10 months besides finding more followers to the Fandango?
Well, obviously, bringing more followers to the Fandango, that's pretty much it. In the months since stepping through the portal, Kothis has spread the word and gained many converts to his church, as much to his surprise as anyone else's. Now, how many souls he has converted and whether these converts are even real or simply in Kothis's head, that's left completely to the discretion of the GM. So, you know, it's up to him. Kothis is even more steadfast in his faith, and he is sure that his actions are growing the glorious power of the Grand Creator. Kothis knows the one above everything, aka the TOAE, simply pronounced the toe, certainly led him to his new companions so they can join together to fight and stop whatever dark forces are at work. But then he started gathering all these lost souls for the Fandango. So he was absolutely sure that this was a righteous quest he was on with Zan and Tiva and Seda. But now he's helping the great masses find the righteousness of the Grand Creator. So that's where he is. But he looks the same. He's not in any way. If to look at him, he looks exactly the same as he did. But he's convinced that he's doing his Lord's work.
Excellent. So as we'll pick it up, it'll be... So Sigil sort of has a false aspect of the seasons and the trees and stuff that are there. They all kind of follow through the seasons, the temperatures drop and stuff. But it'll be sort of what many of you would consider a spring morning here in Sigil. 10 months after your whole issues and your encounters and crux, 10 months to the day. And as you're preparing in the morning, Zan, Tiva, and Seda come in. All three of you have heard a lot of talk lately around the streets, maybe on your tours, as well as the different taverns that you stop at and frequent and visit. But a lot of people seem to be mentioning rumors about the gods dying. It started with you, Zan. You know, you spoke some of these, and people kind of shrugged their shoulders and took it more as a embellished story, something to entertain them on your tours. But it seems like something is actually happening. A lot of people are beginning to point their fingers at the Athar, who tend to denounce the gods and don't want anything to do with them and don't really believe in them anyway. And obviously, they're the type of people that would want the gods to be gone. Other ones are pointing to the Dustmen, who revere death and destruction and basically want to see everything just burn. You've heard rumors that Manzikorian, an Illithid god, has died. Now, you guys know the facts on that, but it seems that word has spread a bit more on that, as well as of Set, and Wim, the god, or the lord of Ooze, he too, or the baron of Ooze, he calls it. People are starting to get a little bit...
Nervous?
Yeah, a little bit nervous.
Now you're getting nervous. Really? Really?
And most recently, this last tour, maybe you're just coming back from finishing one up, Zan, and the three of you come in. Tiva, Seda, and Zan, all three of you give me a search check, please.
No.
Search check? Yeah, I failed.
All right. Where's my search?
Stealth.
Okay.
Yeah,
I was up. I got a 6. So.
We all failed.
You all failed. Who got the lowest?
I got a 5. She got a 6. I don't know what Zan.
I have a 2.
All right, Zan. Then, as you finish off your last little bit of tour here, and you step back up to the double N, double FW there. You'll glance over your shoulder. You can see somebody in the distance. You've noticed they've passed a few days. Every now and then you'll catch them. This Gith in the distance who seems to be watching you with a bit of curiosity. Never, obviously, you know, being offensive or anything. But every now and then it just seems like he's around lately. As you step into your thing, today, as you were giving a tour to a younger elven couple who were new to Sigil, giving them a tour around the bazaar, you know, they asked you about all of the nervousness running through the city about these gods and stuff. They mentioned that they heard that Tomeri was lost too. And maybe as you get back here, just out of instinct, you take out that small little watch you have and look at it. It currently says 12.
Mm-hmm.
It's dinked up a couple times over the past few months here and there, but have you been keeping real close watch on that, or have you tried
to? No, I actually, after my drunkenness, my time of being drunk the whole time, I kind of I still kept it with me, but I never checked and I never wanted to look at it. And I don't want to have anything to do with that. Nope.
As you step in, it's almost like a subconscious instinct. You all of a sudden just find that it's in your hand and you're staring down at it. It currently reads the number 12. Maybe just kind of realize what you're doing and shove it back into your pocket. Shai Sal, you were able to maybe been here for maybe a month now, if that. It seemed word spread pretty quickly about this whole god issue that's been going on. You've heard your fair share of rumors as well. Wasn't hard at all to track down Zan, this Borier, with his business happening. Seems to be in close contact with both the dwarf and Tiva as well. And they're all friends with Kothis, and you probably, being that he's spreading the word on the streets of the Fandango, which you have absolutely no clue what the Fandango is. It seems to be some sort of deity that he follows, but you've never heard of it, and nobody else has either, for that matter. But he has two other people who seem to follow him around currently, spreading words like this. One looks to be not the smartest bunch, kind of a guy. He has a face is a little bit saggy on one side. Looks like he might have had a stroke or something. And the other one is a woman who is much too peppy for your liking that seems to follow him around and copies him word for word like a parrot. But they can be out on the streets, you know, practicing their wares and converting people to the Fandango. Seems Kothis is very happy with all of his followers. Tends to embellish it a little bit, saying he has more than just two. But he seems a little harmless, if not strange. But as you come on the scene, you've tracked this watch down. You do know the Zanhead. He can maybe down the street a few blocks as you watch him and one of the touring jobs for the day and enter his abode. Both Seda and Tiva there. What do you do?
He just walks in, ducks his head under the doorway, and just looks to them. I guess they're like doing something else. And the first thing that they would notice is just the voice saying, "You are Zahn," from the doorway.
I look up from the watch because that it just binged and I looked at it. I flinch. And you're not sure if it's because of you or the watch. I pack it away really quickly, look at Tiva. There's the first one. Yeah, the tour is starting in, yeah. Give me just a minute. Here's your adventuring pack. And I take like a bag from the wall. There are like 20, maybe 30 hanging there. There's your pamphlet in it, a bottle of water, and a sandwich. We didn't have time to choose different options for everyone, but it's the Hive tour, so you can get ready. The cart is in front, and just sit down. We're coming soon. Thanks.
You have the watch? Also, what is a sandwich?
I look back. What? Well, you can see the time outside at the spire, and it's a snack. It's from the Prime.
Your watch is not normal, is it? I know.
What do you know about a watch? I take it out again. I look very suspiciously again down at Seda and Tiva, and like, I mean, they know each other for a long time, so his eyes basically say, if he's doing something weird, smash his face in. And I take out the watch again, and I look at it, hold it up, but not for him to get it, just showing. What do you know about the watch?
Yeah, he wouldn't make a move to take it. He'd say, I know it was taken from the Fraternity of Order, right?
Mm.
Yep.
What do you mean, taken? We got it from Ooh. Our beloved companion, whose name I forgot.
I did at the moment, too. That's why I just said the Fraternity of Order.
You may not have been the original thieves, but it was taken.
I'm pretty sure he would have never taken anything from his order. That's for sure. It was his quest to join us and find out what was wrong.
That is not what I was told. Borrowed, taken, it matters not to me. I'm not here for it.
Why are we talking about it then?
Because that is how I found you, he says, pointing at it.
He wants to turn.
Tiva just kind of runs up to him and says, "Would you like a sandwich?" And then she has her sandwich and she's holding it up to him. "See, this is what a sandwich is. It's food. It's really good."
His hands are like very long and spindly, so he would take two fingers, his index and his thumb, and just like take the sandwich, like look at it. "I eat this?"
"Yes, try it."
"Well, if you eat it, it's one silver piece, and you take the tour."
"I will take the tour. If we can talk."
"Excellent."
And he takes a bite of the sandwich.
Tiva, is anyone else outside waiting?
If you glance outside, Tiva, you'll notice a couple noble-ish looking dwarves are out there, seem to be checking the clock tower spire in the distance, waiting to come in and get a seat. You have four people here. It seems, well, you're not sure if Shai actually is one of the four, but at least two outside.
He'd put down 5 silver and say, a private tour, please. You can wait.
I rub my chin. Tiva, do your thing.
And 4 more sandwiches. He'd say, finishing his first one. I paid 5 silver.
She's the one that made the sandwiches herself, so she beams that he wants 4 more right away, and then she runs off to the back room where, and I'm assuming there's a kitchen. We have a kitchen.
Yeah, of course.
So she's gonna run to the back where the kitchen is, so she can make 4 more sandwiches for him.
Okay, that's fine, Tiva. Now go up front and tell them to do something else. And give them a what's that called? Oh, dang. Give them a gift certificate for next day.
Oh, for the dwarves? Okay.
For the nobles. The nobles. There are four nobles in front.
4 nobles? Okay.
Yeah.
She's gonna run in, she's gonna make the sandwiches, but then she's gonna come back outside. And then she's going to go to the nobles and say, the tour is closed. We have too many people, and here's some certificates, or you can get a free tour then tomorrow. Come back tomorrow. And we'll even give you free sandwiches.
They'll grumble a little bit, but the mention of free sandwiches and free tours seems to abide their time for now. And you can see them turning away. You'll see another man coming towards you, though, Tiva, quickly, sort of, not really at a gallop, more of a trot, but it's another warrior. Older, this gentleman, he has white fur and a long goatee hanging down. And he comes up to you in front of you, Tiva, and he fumbles around in this pack that he has. He looks very, very sick or very tired. He pulls out the small letter, looks at you for just a moment, Tiva, and then just collapses on the ground in front of you.
Oh my goodness! And then she's gonna yell for Zan, and oh my gosh, I've completely forgotten this character's name.
Seda.
Oh my gosh! Total brain fart for some reason. So she yelled out for Seda and Zan, saying, "There's someone who just collapsed here." And then she just you said that he had a piece of paper, looked like it was a note.
Yep.
Okay, but she's going to reach over and she's going to grab the note because, she's curious about it. And then she's going to stuff it in her pocket for the moment. And then she's going to reach down and then she's going to look at him and just kind of shake him. Are you okay?
His body is already cold. It seems, a little bit stiff. Looks like he's been dead for several hours at least.
Oh.
Oh,
I'm going to peek out. And I look back at Shai Sol. Mm-hmm. You eat your sandwich, witches, and I run out. What's that? Tiva, that's not what you were supposed... Oh.
Zan, you will see this old warrior lying on the ground. He's missing a tail. It's your father.
Okay, I don't know what to say.
Dead. Looks like he's been dead for a couple of hours, you kind of guess. His skin's a little paler, cold, stiff. It's definitely your father.
Shit, I break down next to him and I look at Tiva. What in hell?
I don't know. I was talking to the nobleman and he just comes over to me. And he just starts to talk, and then he says, I have this note for you, and then collapses, and he's very cold. It looks like he's been dead for a while, but I don't understand how, because he was walking and talking, but I got the note in my pocket.
Did those idiots use him as a messenger? Just show me the note.
Well, I don't want to show it here. Let's go inside.
Does he look, when you say he looks like he's been dead for a while, does he look decayed?
No, not really.
So
like rigor mortis, he's pale and rigor mortis, probably sitting in and whatnot, but he's not.
Stata would like nudge him really hard with the toe of her boot and be like, "No sleeping, get up."
Seda. And I mean, he was old, so he's not that heavy as I am. So I would try to like drag him into the house.
Down the street a ways, Kothis. Maybe you've been out, bringing your people about and spreading the word. But you'll come around the corner and maybe stop it by the NNFFW for a good sandwich. You've heard they had good sandwiches. Get some lunch there. So you'll see them as they're dragging this dead body into their house.
So business as usual.
Hello, friends. Is this the lunch special?
Kothis, look at this. Come over here.
Kothis goes and checks out.
Look, that's my dad. He died
I'm certainly sorry. I did not know that.
No, it's not recent. It's like
about 10 months 11 ago.
Month ago.
Yeah. Huh? Well, wait. And then they left him here? Who left him?
No.
And Kothis looks even more confused than usual.
No, listen. Listen, some people, some idiot necromancer Burks use dead as their messengers. I don't know how they could get hand on my dad, but they sometimes do that. But how close is your, your devotion to your Fandangle?
Oh, well, I think I understand. That's, I think, beyond my power to, and Kothis is trying to let his friend know that he doesn't think he can do this without admitting that this might be something that the Fandangle can't do.
She pokes him really hard as he's stumbling over his words, and she's like, "Fix it."
I don't know that I can. Let me get this straight. Everything was fine, and then he showed up here. He what?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Give me that note, Tiva.
Tiva pulls it out of her pocket and then starts to hand it to her, or hand it to Zan and say, "I don't think we should read it out here.
We're inside."
Yeah, we went inside.
Trisol is sitting patiently watching.
Yeah, and as I see in the corner of my eyes.
Is this what you call a tour?
You eat your sandwich, we'll be going soon.
The tour will be beginning.
She said, "You eat your sandwich, we'll be going soon."
Yes.
That is your father? Soon. You'd say?
Come into the waiting room and have a seat. So she takes his arm and his spindly arm and says, "Wow, you need to eat more. Here's a couple more sandwiches. Come sit in our waiting room for a moment."
Let him be. Yeah, that's my dad. He died 11 months ago, but yeah, I kind of had some hopes left now that he always used as a plain messenger. He doesn't look dead for 11 months, too. I mean, look at him.
He looks like he's been on ice for quite a while.
Looks like he's been preserved, you'd say. Would you like to speak with him?
Wait, what?
That just took a turn.
In my studies of the arcane mysteries, I I'm able to allow you some limited communication with the dead. If you would like to ask him questions, you can.
Oh.
Kothis puts his hand on Zan's arm and says, listen, friend, before you make any hasty decisions with this necromancer, you got any more sandwiches?
I'm not a necromancer, he'd say.
I would like a sandwich.
I'll hand you one of his.
Thank you. And that's it.
Just a moment. And I look again at Tifa. Give me that friggin' note.
She hands Zan the note. Here.
Out of character, in Seda's defense, I didn't know that was your dad when I was booting him on the ground.
Yeah, I didn't know either.
I'm not sure if you even saw him when he was dead.
She was all like, that's her dad. I'm like, holy shit, I just kicked her dad. I didn't know that.
Well, we did see him, but that's after he had been murdered.
Yeah.
Yeah. Either way. All right. Just wanted to clear that up.
That wasn't intentionally being a dick.
Well, I mean, it fits Seda's.
Yeah, completely. Yeah. Yeah. Perfect.
So I take a deep breath and I start reading, actually loud, because this day is fucked anyway.
You open this little sealed envelope. Looks like it's made of parchment, and it has a little wax seal. It doesn't have a signet on it or anything like that. It just looks like a spattering of wet wax. Crossed it, and you can break free, and you pull out a small piece of parchment inside and unfold it. Only thing that it has on it is what looks to be a crudely drawn goat skull.
A goat skull?
Yep.
Oh, man. I crumble it in my hand. A goat skull. And I, like, push it into... Oh, I don't have pockets. I throw it behind me. And I look at Shysol. And I nod. Free tour for speaking to my dad?
He'd nod.
He already paid, so.
You do refunds. He just wink. Let's get to it.
I give him, of course, back 5 silvers, and I look at him expectantly.
And he'd say, do not be alarmed. You will feel no pain.
We've seen some things.
All right. So you would kind of like, he has like these, it's almost like alien beard kind of thing. Like, it's not hair necessarily. It's like, and like, you'll see these little nodes light up as he touches the corpse's head. Like forehead, and the eyes just flit open, gloss over.
Dad?
And he's just like mumbling very vaguely and quietly.
Speak with dead, I assume?
Yeah.
Let's see. It occurred more than a day ago, so you have 2 questions, Zan, that you can ask it.
Okay, they have to be kind of simple, right?
Yeah, they limit it to what they can say and vocalize, but yeah.
Who sent you here with the letter?
It's glossed over eyes. We'll focus on you, Zan. It's hard to tell if it's any sense of recognition there, or if this is just almost just some mindless being there. Now, there's a part of you that wants your father to answer, but it's not his voice, it's not his accent, it doesn't sound like him at all. It seems almost devoid of any emotion. It says, the necrotic one.
He really holds himself back, not saying who the fuck is that, but Where can we find the necrotic one?
Let me double check to make sure I have the right word, because I don't remember which one it is. let me Google to make sure I got it right. Yeah. You'll see. In the Nine Hells.
Hang on. Which one, Dad? Which one? Which? Oh.
You see his body shudders a little bit. This black, inky, like liquid, spilling from its mouth and kind of crawling across the floor, almost ooze-like or amoeba-like. It seems to have like almost like a life as it pulls itself across the door. This puddle of inky blood or goo headed out towards, you know, like it's trying to pull itself out the doorway into the street.
What the?
What in the hills?
Exactly.
Mage hand, I can try to grab it.
Yeah, you can grab it. It doesn't fight back or anything, but it looks literally just like a small puddle of ooze, about maybe 2 feet in diameter, almost like if you picked up slime.
Does anyone have a flask?
I grab one of the water bottles we use for our lunch packages for the tours. And I hold it under it.
Kothis has a small empty vial, but it's not very big.
Yeah, he'll use either one of those to try to, like, contain it.
Yeah, maybe kind of shove it into a water bottle a little bit or something. And yeah, it's sort of in a bucket sort of form that you can tie it into. You can see a press up. It always, no matter how you carry it, it seems to always be pressing, so it's directed towards the street.
Yeah, nice try thing. I put the stopper on it. Do you know what that is, Mage? And I'll hold it up to him.
No.
What guys, is going on?
Hold that for a second here. On the door.
Oh, no.
Hello? Hello?
Who is it? We're closed.
I have a messenger. Just really? A letter to drop. Just a letter to drop.
Theta, would you be so kind? Seda!
Yes. She goes to get the door.
Open up. You can see it's a younger man. Just regular human or whatever. But he sort of looks down at you, Seda. Holds out one empty palm and hands out the letter to you and stands there waiting expectantly.
She takes the letter and then slams the door in his face.
You hear the curses from outside as he wanders back down the street, none too happy.
She walks over and just like thrusts it out like that and gives it to, hands it to Zan.
It can't get worse, I guess. I open it.
Flip it over, and this one is sealed with a green wax. It does have a signet on it. That of a large sea and a tree. The signets are the sign of Crux. Have you seen Veritas Mav had a ring that would match this seal? Pop that open and open it up. And it is indeed a letter from Veritas Mav. This is, I hope my friends are doing well, and that time has been excellent for you. I hope that you've relaxed, maybe learned a bit about yourselves, and, well, that life is going good. And I do not wish to burden you any, but there's been a request for Zahn by his father to come here to Crux.
At that moment, I take the letter and I just push it into Kothus's chest. You can finish that.
Okay.
As you glance over this, Kothus, you can read all this. And yeah, it seems that Veritas has sent you a letter to basically for Zahn to come and meet his father and Crux. At the end of it, it says that you do not need to take the same route that you did before, that if you seek out Vlerk in the castle clock, then he will make sure that you get here safely and quickly. Best of times, and I hope to see you again. There's been much news here in Crux.
Well, let's start our free tour. What do you say? And I'll look at the door and just march outside, getting the wagon ready. He doesn't look very he looks very sane, but a little bit maybe too sane right now.
Shysaw would say, you can give me the tour on the way to wherever that letter has summoned you.
I'm not sure if we want to go there. Well, what is it? What is it to you, anyway?
There are forces at work greater than all of us.
Well, that's what we tried to tell everyone, and nobody was listening. Now we're trying to live our lives, earn some decent money, and now suddenly everyone sends a message, a messenger, some goo, you, what else? My dad.
You'd say, when I left Limbo, Slod were becoming more powerful, and even the demons were starting to invade. This is not natural. The Mind Flayers, they were weakened a while ago, and I'm not sure what happened. I was told you would know some of these things. You would know more of some of these things.
Oh, you have no idea. I saw a mechanism basically breaking down.
You would see him, like, taken back at that. That explains the rise of chaos.
I saw Seth Proxy explode. And I like do with my hands the explode motion at my hand, like boom. And guess what? We told him we had to talk to his boss, Seth, really urgently. No, Seth can help himself. I'm like leaning at the wagon, my arms folded in front of my chest. You know what? They didn't need help. They didn't need to talk to us three. No, absolutely not. And then, boom! And then everything broke down. You know, the colors from the sky just rained down onto the desert sand. And then we had to run. Finally, we had permission to leave that friggin' hell we were in. And then everything went worse again. You have no idea what's going on. And that, mind you, was 10 months ago.
It has only grown worse since then, yes? It must be remedied immediately. And you see him, like, kind of gain this urgency of purpose.
Well, you know, nobody really, like I said, believes us, and nobody really wants to help us. And now my dad wants to see me, and I mean, as you've seen, Dad is dead now a second time, which is not really nice to see, to be honest, because he's missing his tail. They took his tail. I think I didn't mention that to you yet. So they took his tail, which is absolutely, that's the worst. That's like taking the beard of a dwarf.
I may be able to track his tail if you have some way to convey what it looks like.
He stops, like, mid-sentence.
Seda just points at Zion's butt.
It looks like this. Ah, yes. This will do nicely.
Except it's not attached. That's the difference.
Leave it to the brainiac.
This will work.
If you would notice,
you want to confront. If you want to confront this person, you may be able to find him.
Do we? Can we use a hair of his?
Locate objects. I think he can track down. He can sense the direction of a well-known or clearly visualized object.
Yeah, imagine between like photos that that she has, and I can't imagine Warrior Tales really being all that different. So, yeah. So if you study Zahn's ass enough for a few minutes, you could probably get a location.
At least he's thinking for a moment, and he says, "You know what? I'll come back to that offer, but first I think we have to see what my dad, number three, has to say, because that village seems to be in trouble if my dad is there, because, as you know, my dad is dead. And, well,
most
bloods, and I'll look back at the other three. What do you think?
Go with the shrugs. Meh. He goes back to eating a sandwich.
There's more inside Kothis. I mean, it will go bad anyway if we leave now.
The thing, out of character for just a second, the thing about Kothis is he really loves you guys because he found a group when he was basically wandering. Okay. He's not aware of that. He doesn't understand the depths of his feelings for Teeva and Seda and Zahn, but he still, it's there. So he seems disinterested, but when he's with y'all, he's doing whatever you're doing. That's just the way he is. So anyway. Munch, munch, munch.
Yeah, get the rest from inside. We will be on our way for some time. Teeva, Seda? Up for some adventure again.
Yeah, Seda is basically just kind of looks at you like, are you really asking me something? So she's just going to kind of be like, I go where, and she like reaches over and pets Teeva and say, I go where you go, where she tells me to go.
And Teeva's gonna just nod and say, I'm gonna go make some more sandwiches. So she's gonna run in there. She said, because we're probably gonna get hungry on this adventure.
That's very likely. And I ready the wagon. I point at one seat for Shysol. Well then, have a seat. How do I say that? Are you capable of fighting?
Yes. And he doesn't offer any detail.
I look at you with really a blank face, and I like take from inside my shield and my ram-headed hammer, and I lift it up like this.
More like this. And what would he cast here?
Ooh.
He cast enlarge on you.
Oh.
And like it would last a little while and you would be 120% larger.
Oh boy. Oh, Seda will keel over. Yeah. I start growing and I looked at, oh, I, yeah.
She just looked at you and goes, war goat.
Did you go outside first?
I did go first inside and then out again.
Okay. Just making
didn't
sure.
Destroy my business.
Yeah, you wouldn't do it inside.
Yeah. So when everyone is ready, I would just like take the front part of my wagon and just pull it with a finger. When everyone is sitting inside.
You hear the clop, clop, clop tink of your one skeletal leg as you pull down the street. As everybody's making themselves comfortable, make sure everything's lashed down in this cart. And normal little tour path that you take, you would assume or probably would know that the clock tower that was in the letter would be, you know, the same clock tower that's through most of the city. The same one that Shai saw when he entered as well. It counts up to 13 hours. But as you march in along, Zan, the others don't seem to notice as they're looking about and maybe chatting with one another. But you hear another ding of that watch of yours, which is now at 13.
Oh boy. I look at my backpack and I like try to get that tiny thing out of there because it's now really tiny for me, right? So I hold it between my thumb and my index finger, and I like hold it back into the wagon. It dinged.
Yeah, it would last for 6 rounds, so it wouldn't be.
Oh, rounds. Okay, yeah. Okay. Yeah, in that case, probably I would just take it out as usual, and I still hold it up though. It dinged.
You look at that and you can see that the number 13 is on it. It's always been an unlucky number, Zan, but look at that and let out a bit of a sigh as you go down the street and you look up at this clock tower where you're headed. It too reads the longhand on 13. Your note said that you were looking for somebody named Vlrc, V-L-R-C.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know who that is, though.
So I'm not the only one in business, of course, and I spied out my rival businesses, and who would be the most knowledgeable? Did Accord actually set up his own business?
Oh, yeah, he has one. Sure.
Oh, boy. Yeah, I stop at Accord's.
You can see he's all lashed and ready to go on a tour. Looks like he actually has hijacked your nobles that you were going to take for it later, but they're all set up and they sort of try to, you know, shy their eyes away from you as you come in, Zan.
I give them the stink eye.
Accord will look over. Ah, Zan, how you been, good friend? How you been?
Yeah, later.
Would you like a tour?
No, Vlrc. Vlrc?
Vlrc.
I look at my note again.
Vlrc.
Vlrc.
What about her?
Ah, good. Her. Where?
You know, what do you want?
Your
she doesn't like just anybody.
Now, or I will crush your business under my... Under this one, and I hold up my behind leg like a dog would pee on a wall.
Always so damn difficult, Zan. At the clock tower. Sort of motions down the street. Loud bite.
Jesus.
Motions down the street towards the clock tower. She lives inside the clock. You can call her the Queen of Time. But she doesn't like that very much.
I pat his shoulder, and I just turn around with the whole wagon. Don't get lost with the cord. He tends to lose his way in the hive.
Don't listen to her. Don't listen.
Him. Accord. Him.
No, I clearly meant her. Yeah, if you go to the clock tower, there is a door on the front of it that would lead inside. It's not like watched by anybody. As far as you know, nobody lived there, but...
I look back at the others. Do we knock?
Seda just immediately just bangs on the door.
Oh boy!
I guess we knock then.
Kothis jumps down and goes up to Seda. It's an excellent idea.
Guys, slam on the door. Maybe Shai saw as you sat back a little bit. The other one seemed to be a little more. Jumped the gun a bit, but you glance up at this place. You can see movement behind the clock face tower. It's like a large window, but there's definitely somebody up behind there. But they, the figure that you see behind there doesn't move. It's like they're looking out and down under the street. We can't make, it's more of a silhouette from your angle. You can't really make out what it is.
I secure the wagon with a little lock at a fence close by. And I walk back. Well?
But, yeah, otherwise, there's no answer at the door.
Oh, we don't have time for this, Seda. I'll look at the door.
I can open it.
Yeah.
So she just pulls her axe off of her back.
Oh, whoa, 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 whoa. Use that. And I point at the knob or whatever is there.
So she'll reach forward and she's like, oh. And she tries the doorknob.
It is. Nice heavy door. It is locked.
So she looks back, holds her axe and goes, key?
Is there a window nearby?
I do have.
Besides the clock face, no.
Go ahead, Michelle.
I've got 3 pips into open doors. Is that?
Yep, you could try that.
Okay.
Well, you might want to ask. Do we want to pick the lock or not?
I look at Shaisal and I say, we have sometimes very unconventional methods to get things done. It's fine.
So it is all the same to me.
Tiva's going to walk over and try to open the door, pick the lock herself. And I got a 2.
Yeah.
And it's 3. So that means success? Okay.
So take you a few moments as you go over and starts. You'll try the door first, and it doesn't open, and then you try puttering with a little bit, and TV, you step up there with your small little lock picks and get to work. If you glance up, I saw that silhouette that was in the clock face window above is gone. Takes you a few moments, Tiva, to get that thing, you know, situated. It's actually a rather difficult walk, but you're able to get it. You hear that soft click as it comes loose.
The door opens up on me.
Yeah. All right. So so she steps back and she just kind of says, okay, Seda, now try to open the door.
So she does.
Step up and turn the door handle. It swings open outward towards you. So give it a bit of a pull and it swings open. This damp, very earthy smell of dirt and stone, almost like a cavern would smell, seems to billow out of here. It takes a few moments for everybody's eyes to adjust to the darkness inside this thing. But standing in the doorway, it stretches up about 9 feet tall, is a giant ant.
9 feet tall?
Yes.
Like an ant? Like an little ant.
No.
Like a bug.
Normal?
Yeah, I was going to say, like a bug.
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
No.
It's dressed. It has a very nice leather little corset thing that goes around its chest and a, sort of almost like this frilly tutu-ish type thing around its, I guess its thorax it would be called.
What?
Four legs would be on the ground. The two upper legs would be more like hands as it's sort of kind of danced up, almost like a praying mantis would be.
I'm not really surprised by this, right? I mean...
No, probably not.
Yeah.
If anybody wants to give me a 1d6 roll, if anybody gets a 1, you will recognize what this thing is.
Okay.
Not I.
I got a 5.
Ooh.
Tiva got a 1.
Maybe in your times as halflings, you know, people telling stories, maybe you've looked through some Halfling Geographic magazines over the years, but this would be a Fomorian. Basically like a humanoid ant-like creature.
So say I was laughing, so she missed it.
It would be a Fomorian.
A Fomorian. Oh. Okay. So what do I know about these Fomorians?
So you know that they sort of work like ant hives and stuff. They are intelligent, sentient creatures, quite intelligent, actually. They usually have a queen that kind of rules over the mound, and they're civilized. Sometimes they're more evil, or sometimes they're better, but depends on where they are and such. But otherwise, they're like intelligent insect, not really humanoids, but they do stand up on their four back legs, and the front ones are hands.
And this one's wearing a tutu.
And a corset, yes.
Because why the hell not?
Madame Flirt? Flirt?
Flirk?
Flirk?
Flirk.
That was wrong.
Flirk.
Yes.
An ant wearing a corset and a tutu.
Tiva. Tiva.
What?
You see these large black orb-like eyes sort of look over at you, Tiva. Yes. People often laugh at me.
No, they don't laugh
long.
I am not laughing, Shysel says. Just straight face.
Character was laughing. I was
looks terrified, like, what is this? This is not normal.
So yeah, no, I was her character, my
Tiva was laughing.
I was. So she looks and goes, oh, you're a Flamorian. I've never seen one of you before. But I've heard of you. And then she looks around and everybody else, it's a Flamorian.
Yeah, I heard that. I'm surprised you know.
Yes, yes.
Seda leans over and goes, she's pretty smart.
Nevertheless, Madame Flirk. I'm very sorry that we had to disturb you, but that we picked your lock. But this is kind of important. We got a note that we had to go to Crux and that you could provide us with a passage of some sort.
This thing will stare at you with these black glistening eyes, its head cocked to one side as it listens. Come in. It'll turn and start walking into the darkness.
I'll look back at the others, shrug, and walk in.
Inside is just covered in dirt and this sort of looks almost like clear, glistening slime type stuff. It seems to be on the walls and on the floors and stuff. Tunnels are not really, I guess, tunnels, but it seems like all of the stairwells and the hallways and this are sort of caked in this dirt and slime stuff, much like the inside of an anthill would look that has been created. But you'll see crates and crates of stuff scattered all over the place. Everybody give me a search check.
This is very pretty, Madam Flirk. I rolled a 6.
That's a d6. I got a 1.
I got a 3 and I got a 3. So I made it.
Michelle got hers.
I got a 2.
Right. So for those that pass, as you pass by some of these crates and stuff, you'll see some are loaded with these burlap sags of white powder. Some of them have these strange green leaves and stuff. It only takes you a few moments to realize that all of these crates contain booze and drugs.
Oh.
But Vlick doesn't really pay any attention. She'll look over her shoulder to make sure that everybody is at least following her. Then she'll skitter up, sometimes on the wall, ceiling, or whatever. It doesn't really matter for her, but up this sort of tunnel stairwell thing that leads up to the top of the tower. She doesn't say anything. She just expects you to follow her as she goes on up.
While we're walking up there, I turn around to Shysol and I say, you knew my name, so this is Tiva, Seda, Kofith. What's yours?
You say that to Vlerk?
No, to Shysol. Oh. Because we were like, we didn't really have a, like, an exchange of name.
Yeah, we didn't really introduce ourselves.
Oh, he gave his name.
He did? Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, then I take that back. Sorry. Then I'm following.
You come into this large open room that is just filled with hundreds, if not maybe thousands, of small dolls and knickknacks. everything just, some of them are like stuck to the wall by the slimy goo stuff. Some are on makeshift dirt shelves and pedestals. She'll crawl over and take a sort of skittering stop on top of this mound and settle herself down. And these black, beady eyes just staring at all of you. She doesn't make a sound or doesn't move, doesn't say anything, just stares at you.
I'll look around for some archway or door or whatever, anything that could be a portal.
Only thing you would see that could probably be a portal would be the clock face tower window, door, clock face, whatever you call it.
I like point at it. Is it this?
See your head cock and look over. Cock. No. Who sent you?
Well, what's his name?
Veritas.
Veritas. Thank you. Veritas from Crux.
Good man. Been a long time since I saw him.
Mm-hmm.
She'll look over and she reaches over with this long spindly fingers and picks up the small white cube from a dirt table beside her and sort of chomps on it with a bit of her mandibles and then holds it out to use on sugar cube.
Thanks. No.
So you want to go to Crux, yes?
Well, no, you can't say want. We have to.
And why is that?
Because we, we have some kind of friendship with Veritas. And the town seems to be in trouble, and we kind of feel a little bit bound to it, you know, soul-wise and
so
such.
So you wish to go quickly, be in a hurry, yes?
That would be very helpful, yes.
And there's this, like, brief pause for a moment, and then in a quick flash, you'll scurry off this mound and just come face to face with you, Zen.
Whoa! Whoa!
You see, almost if a ant could smile, it would. These black, like orbs staring back, says, "I know where you need to go."
But well, that's good. Could you just tell us? That would be amazing.
Are you afraid of death?
Well, you know, everyone kind of is.
And we'll reach up this hand and it sort of strokes the side of your face, these sharp nails inside your cheek. It sort of traces your cheekbone across your chin. You sweat, Zan. That is your name, right? Zan? Buck of Gel?
Uh-huh. No kidding.
How is the touring business?
Oh, excellent. Well, I have some rivals there, and Accord is being a pain in the ass, but yeah, aside from that, everything's fine.
Finger, claw, ant nail, whatever you call it, traces down your neck and sort of across your chest.
I have a girlfriend.
And it's head will cock. Chill. Looks at the floor a little bit and scurries across. You can see she reaches down again to one of these cubes. Lifts it out and sort of rubs it on the side of her face, this clawed, powdery side on the side of her cheek. Yes. Have you ever had two girlfriends on?
Say the Snickers.
She'll sort of circle around you every now and then, sort of brushing at your fur. Sort of twirls your tail in her finger.
I don't think I can. I wiggle my butt. I don't think I can handle two. I only have one. That's none of your business. But, can you stop that, please?
Tiva's going to look over. Who's your girlfriend, Zan? I've never seen you with one.
Oh, I give you the devil stink eye. Oh, boy.
You know, son, it hurts me a little inside when people lie. Do you not like me?
No.
Nobody ever likes me.
No, you know, I mean, it's very fresh. They don't know about it yet. It's.
No, I don't care. I'll let you go on your ways, and she'll go over and pick off one of these small little dolls that she has, and comes back over to you, Zan. She will put it into your pouch.
Uh-huh.
Says, well, the portal you want is in Accord Stables. I know what you're thinking. You don't want to go there and deal with him, but that's the way the cookie crumbles, and that's the way it crumbles.
The Court Stables.
Yes, yes.
That's not three. Very...
Don't interrupt me.
Yes.
Now, listen. It's not safe. You can't be afraid to die because, well, most people die. But if you're in a hurry, then this is the path you take, yes? You be safe, though, because... I think you owe me a bit of payment for this, right? Right? I mean, is Veridus going to pay for this? Who's paying for this? You are excellent, excellent. I could see it in your eyes. I only want one thing, Zan. But we will figure out the details when you return. Until then... I have business to attend to. Go to the stables. You can use this doll. You just have to place it in a promiscuous sort of position over in the corner of the stables. And the portal will come. Now listen, listen, all of you listen very close. This portal leads through the prime world of Renee's. It is a dead world, one destroyed eons ago, sacrificed the entire thing to a god of death. Do not touch anything. Do not speak to anything. Do not, you know, don't do anything. Just go to the portal. You will see a house of black marble. In the basement is the portal that you will need. Now it leads back to Yggdrasil, actually outside the town of Crux. So there is no key. It's just a one of those shimmering orbs that seems to glisten on the tree leaves. But yes, seek out the house of black marble, and in the basement is the portal that you seek. It is maybe half day's travel at the best, and that's going slow. But do not touch anything.
Do not do anything. House of black marble. Shimmering portal. Gotcha.
And when you return, like... Zan, then we can, you know, discuss payment.
Yes.
So, sort of trace this fingernail across your chest.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent.
Tifa comes running up and holds out a sandwich. Would you like a sandwich?
And I'm gone.
As a distraction.
This calls out. May the fandangle light your path, bug thing.
So you guys, last look, you can see her resettling back on this mound of dirt, just chewing on this large cube of sugar, per se, and rubbing it all over her body, across her tutu. As you leave the clock tower.
I'm stumbling out of it. Like, what in the... What? Why? As I fiddle around with my little padlock on the wagon.
You might not notice as much, Zan, since it's on you, but Tiva, Seda, Shai, and Gothis, you smell, Zan, this really sweet almost exotic, sugary sort of smell that seems to be radiating off of him.
Is that a new cologne, Zan?
I don't want to talk about it. Leave me alone.
What? You were very nice.
Just get into the wagon.
It smells like donuts.
It was a pretty nice bug thing.
For Maury.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Yeah. Next time you can talk to her, feel free to do whatever you want with her. Have a seat now.
I think she wanted to do whatever she wanted with you, Zan. Why do you smell so sweet?
Smell like.
I don't. Leave me alone. Get into the wagon. We're in a hurry.
So she just kind of giggled. Off in the wagon.
Say that, get up there and sit her and lean over.
Actually, that does sound good. I didn't bring any donuts with me, though.
I get ready to start pulling the wagon away as quickly as possible, as barrier-wise possible.
Yes, you'll see a silhouette in the window that seems to watch you. You should pull away back to Accord's place. He is not currently there, as he is currently giving a tour to the nobles that you dissed, but you can see his stables are in the back. There's a couple of horses there for some of his other workers, unlike himself, that aren't pulling wagons. Seems to be safe.
I'll look around at the vicinity. Oh, you know what? Accord isn't, well, he is smart, but he just doesn't see the details. So I just put my wagon into his wagon, barn, whatever, stable, in the last corner. Like hiding it in plain sight. Mm-hmm. And what did she give me? I didn't know that word. I'm sorry.
Is it a doll?
Yep, what? A small doll.
Oh, like a puppet.
Yep.
Oh, sorry. Okay. Yeah. So she said the most promiscuous corner.
Yep. It goes into the third stable in the corner in a promiscuous position.
I don't even want to know what that means, but yeah, let's go to the third stable.
Just place that down in whatever kind of position you wish and activate this portal. You can see this shimmering light appear underneath some of the hay and stuff. You wipe it away and you can actually see that there's a sewer grate there that, you know, like they would toss a lot of the waste and stuff down into, but it goes down into the sewer system, but it's seems to be activated as it shimmers with this real silvery sort of light.
Well then, get in.
Yeah.
You have to tell me twice.
Yeah.
Don't touch anything. Don't do anything aside from walking.
But what about...
I guess you can pee, but... I'm not sure. Just hold it in.
As you step through this silvery sort of void-like portal, it's very, very, very cold. You know, it's sort of a unnatural cold that washes over you, like jumping into a cold bucket of ice. And you'll climb down this shimmering, silvery-colored ladder. And it just seems almost fluid as the world comes around you and you're climbing down the side of this building with a, looks like steel grating is up the side of it and you're walking down it. And you look around this world, you see these towering buildings, some 15, 20 stories high into the eye or sky. Most of them are just crumbling messes, falling apart. The streets are just littered with garbage, rock, rubble. And you see these large metal-like wagons that are just scattered. Some of them are overturned. Some of them scattered across the streets. Twisted iron, steel grating, The whole thing looks just completely alien to all of you. There's fallen columns of buildings, large metallic beams, some smaller structures. Mostly are quite large, though. Most of them are just, you know, stories upon stories high. And you can see the, you guess maybe it's a sun. It looked just like a small star in the sky, way off. The whole world is cold and just has this sort of dead silence. You don't hear anything. And to meta a little bit, it would basically be an apocalyptic city of modern times.
Yeah, I thought so.
That's what I was thinking. I was like, wow. So, okay. Well, that certainly makes it easier to visualize. So Seda's just immediately looking around like, you know, she sees all the buildings torn down. And she's just like, does it look like it's, so it's apocalyptic, but it does it look like it's been severely aged? Or is it just like
recently? Oddly enough, no, it looks almost preserved. And maybe in this, everything's covered in snow and frost from, you know, the sun being so far away. It doesn't look like it just like a bomb went off recently or anything. It just looks very, very old and ancient, but very preserved.
So the buildings are pretty much intact. There's just nothing around and everything's kind of overgrown and then done in frost. So she kind of look around and go, well, at least the buildings are holding up, but where it, this place looks like a ghost.
It's amazing.
Street that you're on, it seems to be this weird, not really cobblestone, but it seems like one just long stretch of rock. You can see yellow lines are painted on it. These weird wagons that are scattered across the streets as you start to move down, some of them are overturned, just twistings of metal and pipe and wiring. I guess maybe Seda, you'd be familiar with at least some of the, you know, concepts of what these things are. Buildings are, looks like, you know, as you look at these buildings, they, they're, the construction is far beyond even that of the dwarves, would be in the integration of metal and stone and other weird contraptions you're not quite sure of. The whole thing's just alien looking. A few streets kind of branch off in different directions, but most of them are overgrown or whatever. It just looks like this one long street that you're on that goes off into the distance is the only one that's really a clear path to follow.
So she immediately has this overwhelming desire to like walk over and start inspecting everything, but then she remembers Zan being all mean about don't touch anything.
Yeah, why don't you give me a save versus magic?
Uh-oh. They got him a dwarf. Well, do I have to roll over it, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so I'm not doing well at all.
Yes, you would be quite interested in poking around in this and just maybe trying to get an idea. You may not be the smartest, but you still have the sense of a dwarf and the curiosity of the just the absolute engineering and architecture of this place is phenomenal.
I immediately make my way toward the nearest like rubble pile or structure or whatever. I failed to roll really bad. So I immediately am walking over to go inspect it.
Dana, where are you going?
Yeah.
She's like, I just want to look at it.
I don't think we should be touching anything.
Get it.
Nice little pile of rubble here, Seda. You can see some odd piping, some carvings, but there's one, it's just a couple stones down. It looks almost like a slate of obsidian or something. You can see some sort of a diagram maybe on it. It's very, very interesting.
We've only just met. I'd like to learn more about you before you suffer some ill fate in a dead world. You'd just say like a few feet back from you. He wouldn't physically try to stop you, though.
Yeah. So she's going to look back toward where Zan and Tiva are. If they're still over at the road, she's just going to reach down and pull the slate out.
All of you can hear this high-pitched scream, almost like a banshee sort of scream as it wails through. And then it's just silence once again. Maybe it was just a bird in the distance. But you look at this slate of obsidian that you have in your hands, Seda. It's maybe a foot in diameter, sort of like a, basically a black tile. But you can see that it's been like carved with maybe a sharp stone or something's been scraped into it. And it's sort of the shape of a smiling mask.
What is that?
A smiling mask that looks a lot like the
the
white mask.
Yep.
We should go.
She's immediately going to like pull the rock aside and shove it right back where she got it from, and immediately and start walking really fast back over to where everybody else is.
Aren't we supposed to not touch anything anyway?
We're going now.
Oh yeah, we're going.
Well, you guys don't even know what was on it.
Yeah, I don't care.
I saw what was on it.
Yep. So as we walk, I will, in the best that I can, explain the black slate is carving of the white mask people on it.
How did that come here?
I don't know. Can we go?
Yeah, we can.
I need to do Caesar's breath weapon from everybody.
Oh, shit.
Zeta.
Breath weapon?
Yep.
Where's that at?
Breath weapon is the one in the middle.
Yep.
Ooh, no.
All right. That's a D20?
D20 and roll above that number.
Okay, and that's just a straight.
Yeah, I am not. Okay.
Above.
By the light of Fandango.
I got a 17 and I needed a 14.
Koth has made it with a 15.
All
right. I made it. I only needed a 10.
All right. Tiva did not. And Zahn?
Nope.
No. So the both of you, as you're moving down the street, maybe it takes about 10 minutes or so, but Tiva and Zahn, you guys are getting cold. Not, you know, it's not just like a chill in your bones or whatever. You are absolutely freezing. You can see the tips of your fingers are starting to get covered in frost. You can feel it in your lungs. It just burns. Your face hurts. And you clearly were not outfitted for this, but both of you are going to have a minus 40 or strength until you can basically get rest or get out of this.
Mm-hmm. I think this calls for a bit of speed. You've cast haste.
Oh,
nice. Yeah, we'll just say affects everybody, huh? Worried about it. Yeah, you can start moving through the streets and going down any of the side streets you stop to sort of peer down. Most of them are overgrown or just have large buildings and crumbles. It seems to be the main street that you're on is the only one that really is any sense of path through here. I mean, you could definitely go down a side one, but it'd be a lot more work. And, you know, this lady said not to, or this Formian said not to really touch anything. So continue down this main street and you'll pass eventually this huge open expanse that's on your right, just acres upon acres of what looks to be once had trees or something. You can see a couple pools of frozen over water now and mostly just dead vegetation scattered about. And it takes about a half hour or so as you're walking along. The only really sign of where you might be or like any sort of names or whatever is you keep passing these small little square or greenish colored rectangle signs that says Fifth Avenue. As you walk down the street, most of the buildings here still in ruin, but Zahn, maybe you notice at first, maybe 300-400 yards up front, you see this, not a tower, it's maybe like 4 or 5 story building shaped sort of like a pyramid of just pure black marble.
That looks like what we're looking for.
As you continue down this, Tiva, you will feel this cold brush across the back of your neck. Give me a save versus perilous.
I made it. I got a 19.
You can feel as you take a few steps and then your whole body just seems to almost tense up. And for a few moments, you're completely unable to move. But you see this wisp of smoke that sort of wraps around you. You can see this demonic-y skull-like face in the smoke. It stops in front of yours for a few moments and hovers there, just in the fog, and then it wisps away once your body is able to start moving again. And Shaisal, as you move along, you can feel there's something here. Something's following you. And you notice this small little hiccup in Tiva's step. You couldn't see what she saw, but you definitely seen this fog or this smoky sort of air around her sort of dissipate.
Yeah, he would be trying to get everybody to run as fast as they can. He can't cast haste again, so.
Shit.
And she kind of, you know, she's shivering, she's freezing, and she is also kind of spooked with what she just saw. I think we need to get out of here as quickly as possible. So she starts to run.
Yeah, I'm hobbling along, being half frozen.
Is this sort of fear starts to well up or whatever, and everybody takes off into a run. It's almost as if that triggering instant, everything around you seems to just let out the screeching scream. You see what looks to be these mistless sort of forms crawling out from buildings underneath these metal wagons between the rubble, down the side of buildings and grates, maybe 15, 16 of them, as they all start to encircle around you. You can see that they look humanoid. They're about the same size as a human, but they're slouched and their proportions are off. Some of them have longer arms or legs are twisted, and they all seem to have this skull-like face built into the smoke that makes up their face, but it's more skull and sort of glaring red eyes.
You have to touch, Paisal says.
Kothis, you would recognize these things since you have a little bit of a priestly following. They are wraiths.
Oh, more than one.
In that case, I will suddenly have some mental clarity and say, these creatures are not our friends, as if you didn't know that. But he seems to be somewhat authoritative for a change.
Oh, really, Kothis?
Yeah. Thank you for the illumination.
Yeah. Hobble, hobble, hobble. Run, run. It's not far anymore.
The closer you get to this black house, or this actually it's more like a small ziggurat type pyramid thing, but you'll notice more of these buildings have these large porcelain mask scrawling scribbles on them. You'll start to see some that match the goat skulls, and they're just everywhere, like graffiti everywhere, and it gets more and more the closer you get to this black pyramid. And even the pyramid itself, this black marbled house per se, is covered in this white chalky graffiti of porcelain masks and rotting goat skulls. But all these rays will quickly encircle around you. You can try to bust through them if you want, but they're basically formed a circle around all of you, and they're just getting closer and closer. They don't look like they're immediately, like, they're not throwing out attacks or anything, but they're definitely trying to surround you and contain you.
I think I have something that Nope. Never mind. Okay. Go ahead.
Kothis will pull out his holy symbol and try to turn these things.
You'll see quite a few of them. You don't have to roll anything. Shy away quickly. And they sort of back up a little bit. But there's three of them that seem to be almost unaffected by this Kothis. You keep able to keep the other ones at bay. And it seems more and more crawling from the rubble each moment. But these three other ones sort of form a pyramid around you, one in front of you and kind of two off to the back sides. And they step forward a little bit and they just watch all of you. They don't make any attacks or anything. And they sort of snicker at you, Kothis, with your measly godlike symbol.
Oh, that makes Kothis angry. They seem to not care about the mighty power of the Grand Creator.
How close are we to the place we're trying to get into?
Yeah, about 100 yards.
So, Seda would, I guess, pull her Actually, she would probably use her... She would probably pull her great axe again and say, well, I have the holy symbol too. And she'll look over at Zahn and everybody else and she'll say, do we make a hole?
I have a better idea. Get close to me.
I look a little bit skeptical at Shysal, but I mean, there's really no way to get out of here. So I just, I shove my butt over to you.
And she goes over and lean in and kind of try to get warm because she's still freezing.
He'd wait for everybody to get within 10 feet radius. And then, so I need to cast without a slot. What does that do again?
You don't have to worry about the details of it at the moment. I'm not sure off the top of my head, but it wouldn't be up to a big deal right here, so.
Okay. So, like, you get close, and then you look to each other and realize that you're invisible. Run for the door.
First, before I run, I look at the wraith.
Seda doesn't. She just immediately runs for the door. Because that's what she was told to do.
Yeah, they, as soon as you go invisible, they will sort of look around you. They can tell that you're there, and they can sense you, but they can't see you. So they, you know, that sense of confusion as they sort of look between each other and where you were, and you know, a bit of confusion across all of them. Definitely would have a moment to break free and run if you wanted to.
Yeah, in that case, yep. I run.
Running!
Yes, running.
Seda, as you all take off running, actually Tiva, because you have a little bit of slowness to you since you are freezing cold. Everybody takes off running. You can feel everybody's close by, move between these rays and towards this building, but it's hard to tell, you know, who everybody's there. You can hear the pounding of feet, but you can't see one another. You just hope that everybody's there. But you will feel this heavy grab a hold of the back of your hair, Tiva, and you come to a sudden halt. This misty-like figure standing in front of you, holding the back of your head, says, ah, I got you, little one. And they'll start to sort of walk away, pulling you with it. Seda, Zahn, and Shyslam, Kothis, you guys will be able to reach this ziggurat tower and run through the doors quickly, waiting for a few moments. You can see as you turn around in the distance, these rays seem to be dispersing a little bit, but three of them are still standing in the street, and they seem to be around, surrounded, like, you know, around one another, talking to each other or something. And then Zahn, you will become visible. Seda, Shy, and Kothis. All four of you are there, but Tiva seems to be missing. And then you will see her just a few moments later, blink back in, held up by the back of the scruff of her neck by one of these things in the distance. Tiva, what do you do?
She's going to start screaming. She's going to start screaming, let go! And then she's going to try to yank away from whoever it is that's got a hold of her.
Your hand just sort of whiffs through this foggy mist-like stuff. It seems like it has a tangent hold on you, but if you kick at it and try to push it away or try to pull its hand free, it's just fog to you. It just whisps about you. You can hear this thing snicker a little bit. It says, no, we have words, little one, words. Stop your thrashing, and I'll set you down.
She just kind of, well, she can see the fog. She's going to just kind of calm down a little bit. What words? What do you want from me? Let go of me!
We want your soul, little one. Just a soul. It's all we want.
Well, you can't have it!
To feel the warmth again. And you'll see these three are getting really close around you. Again, it's just
I cast fog. Magic missile at it.
Perfect. It is 6 o'clock, so we will end it there.
Yeah, I was going to say,
the hanger of cliffs. Excellent.
Yeah.
Yes, hanger of cliffs.
Just stay as charging right back out the door again.
Very, very, very well done.
Yeah. Initiative. All right, let me make a note.
Dang it.
What, we took a couple months off? Says who?
All right, let me stop this thingy.